Welcome everyone to Pittsburgh, where the weather is perfect for a championship game in early December. The snow is falling, the temperature in the low 30s. Today at Heinz Field, Cincinnati and Pittsburgh square off in a head-to-head battle for the Big East Conference title and an automatic bid to a BCS bowl game. Brian Kelly's Bearcats arrive with a 17-game regular season winning streak and hopes of playing for a national championship still alive. They want to march into a BCS bowl for the second year in a row as they take on Dave Wanstead and his Pitt Panthers. The coach looking for his biggest win in his five seasons as head coach at his alma mater. Welcome everyone to College Football presented by K Jewelers. Today from sold out Heinz Field, one of the biggest games of the year in college football, number 5 Cincinnati and 15th ranked Pittsburgh for the Big East title. Cincinnati is 6-0 in conference play. They've already clinched at least a share of the Big East regular season title. But Brian Kelly says we're not playing to be co-champions. Pittsburgh is playing for that today and the winner of this game with a Big East automatic bid to a BCS bowl game. Hello, everybody, and welcome. I'm Sean McDonough along with Matt Millen. Delighted to have you with us. We'll be joined by Holly Rowe in just a couple of moments. A huge game. Cincinnati under Brian Kelly is getting accustomed to playing in them, and they have so much to play for today, including keeping their hopes for a national title alive. But first things first, win the Big East outright. And as they try to do that, they have the best offensive team in the league and one of the best in the country.
And it's wide open, and they spread the field. And boy, do they throw the football all over the place, and with good reason. They've got an outstanding quarterback, 6'6", Tony Pike. What makes him special? Well, first of all, he sees the whole field. But this is the piece that gets lost by most people. He is very good with his escapability. He can get to his left, he gets to his right, he can stand in the pocket, but he delivers an accurate ball, and that's what they've been living on all season long. And when he's really on, the guy he's finding right there, Marty Gilliard, this guy's special. He's special in the return game. He can take it to the house. But with the ball in his hands as a receiver, he's exciting from any place on the field. And that's what makes this team really exciting.
It's hard to believe, but Pittsburgh has been in the Big East since 1991, and they've won only one conference title, and that was a four-way share back in 2004. So they want this Big East title to co-share it with Cincinnati and go to a BCS bowl game. People didn't know what to expect when the season began. They lost LeSean McCoy. They found a very quick answer in the freshman in Deion Lewis.
Hey, I'm going to be straight with you. I never thought I'd say these words. Deion Lewis is as close to Barry Sanders as I've seen, and I'm shocked. This kid, to me, is rare. He has elite running skills. He does some things that I hope we can show you today that are just freakish. He freezes people in their tracks. He can run away from you. I'm excited. I don't know if you can't tell, but I'm excited to watch this kid play because he is really special.
He's the fourth leading rusher in the nation, and he's breaking some of Tony Dorsett's records. Cincinnati and Pittsburgh for the Big East Championship, the kickoff in a moment.
It's a thin line between winning and losing. No second place trophies, either you winning or losing. Proof is in the pudding, which side is you choosing? Leave it on the field, no time for confusion. No rest for the weary, no room for the weak. Survival of the fittest when it's time to compete. Every minute, every hour, every day of every week, we all steady aiming for the top of the heap.
College football presented by K Jewelers, brought to you by Nissan Maxima, proud partner of the Heisman Trophy.
Festive atmosphere here at Heinz Field. 32 degrees as we approach kickoff. Just a light wind along the banks of the Allegheny River. And the forecast is for more light snow as the day goes along. Down on the field, here's Holly Rowe.
Hey guys, well, as you know, the Pittsburgh Panthers share this stadium with the Pittsburgh Steelers. Plus, there were four high school playoff games, state championship games here on the field. So they've had to resod the field. It got torn up pretty good. They put the sod in on Saturday, but as you can see, there's still some seams where they rolled out the big pieces. This field was grown in New Jersey at Tuckahoe Farms, and they grew the field in its complete form for 2 years. So this is pretty tight, solid grass. Then they sheared it off and brought it in here. Each piece was about 10,000 pounds, and they've rolled it out. Watching the players in warm-ups, it's a pretty good track. However, this light, fluffy snow that's falling is making it a bit slippery. I did see some of the Cincinnati guys go down in their warm-up period, so keep an eye on the track. As you know, Pittsburgh loves to run the ball. And Brian Kelly told me he doesn't anticipate the weather being an issue at all because wind is the only thing that really disrupts their passing game.
And it is a prolific passing game. Cincinnati won the toss and will receive, so Luke Briggs will kick off for Pittsburgh. And this battle for the Big East title in the BCS bowl bid is underway. Marty Gilliard, one of the most dangerous return men in the country, four career kick returns for scores, and good coverage there by Pittsburgh as Gilliard was taken down at the 22-yard line by Giovanni Chappelle. Here's Tony Pike, one of the nation's leaders in pass efficiency, coming off one of the best games of his career. School record 6 touchdown passes last week and 399 wins in their win over Illinois. And that took them to 11-0 for the first time in school history. And he has amassed those numbers in only 8 games. Missed time this year with a left arm injury. Returned as the starter last week and didn't skip a beat. Out of the shotgun. It's a prolific hit pass rush, and the pass is incomplete, intended for Armon Binns. Pike will have to contend with the fierce rush from the Panthers, who lead the nation in sacks with 42.
And so, Sean, that's a key for the Cincinnati Bearcat offense. You know what they can do with Tony Pike, and they have the receivers outside, but to me, it's going to come down to their inside 5 people. And both this Pitt defensive front, pretty good. Both these ends get up the field and give pressure pretty well.
Pike averaging 259 yards per game passing, hands it off to Jacob Ramsey, the senior, back in action after missing last week's win with a foot injury. And he lost his helmet on his return to action, tackled by Max Gruder and Mick Williams.
Now, when you watch and talk to Brian Kelly, watch this offense. One of the things he told us is, if they play us in a straight zone, like I think they're going to, we're going to have some success. But, he said, we're going to have to be able to protect. But if you watch the tape a week ago, they went with zones, they spread the field, and they mauled them.
Pike on third down and long. It's hit as he tries to throw, and it's incomplete. Hit by Greg Romeus, one of those outstanding defensive ends, the junior from Coral Springs, Florida.
Romeus, wherefore art thou, Romeus? That's what they needed to do all game long. He's a big, powerful guy. He's got good movement, very long. And like we said earlier, these tackles for Cincinnati, they've struggled against good pass rushers.
Sorry. Dave Wanstead thinks both of his defensive ends, Romeus and Jabal Sheard, will play in the NFL. Jake Rogers, a good punt. Aaron Smith, a good return. And that's a bonus for Pittsburgh. Wanstead said yesterday we're not very good in punt return, and the facts bear that out. They're 107th in the country in punt returns, averaging under 5 per return, but that was a 14-yard run back of a 48-yard punt. Coach Wanstead said, I'm happy if we catch the punt. He got a little more than he was hoping for there. Well, here's Bill Stull, one of 18 seniors playing in their final home game here at Heinz Field. And for these seniors, the biggest game of their careers. Right away to Deion Lewis, showing some of that ability that reminds Matt of Barry Sanders as he goes out of bounds in Cincinnati territory at the 44, right off the bat, a 12-yard gain.
Now, I don't want to put a lot on this kid, but look at this. This kid has great, not good. He has exceptional balance, off the charts. His feet are always under him.
even when he takes a hit, Sean, he's one of those guys that kind of absorbs the hit and almost uses the power against you. He's just rare. I was shocked watching the tape.
Fourth in the nation in rushing, leading freshman rusher in the country. Trying the middle this time, and he is powerful as well. He's just 5'8", 195 pounds, but his teammates yesterday when we visited with them marveled at his strength. He benches about 360, squats 500. John Malecki, the offensive guard and team captain, said back in the spring he went to get on the scale down in the weight room, and he looked up at the boards where they have all the top marks for weightlifting right in the program, and Lewis's name was at the top of just about every list.
That's depressing. When you're a lineman and you look up there and the 5'8" running back is at the top of the list, you know you got work ahead of you.
And he's just starting in a college weight program under Buddy Morris, the legendary strength and conditioning coach. Lewis again ran into Andre Revels, Cincinnati's leading tackler and inside linebacker. They'll play a 3-4 base defense under a new defensive coordinator in Bob Diaco, who had to replace 10 starters from the Cincinnati defense of a year ago.
That Revels, he's a good one. He finds the football pretty well, and he's very active. But for me, this line, the defensive front, that's the one who's going to have to control this running game, and in particular their nose tackle at Derek Wolf, number 95. He's just a freshman. He's pretty active. State wrestling champ. You know I love those guys.
Third and three. Stull went out of the shotgun. Has a man in the flat. It's Lewis for a first down. He's also a good receiver. That's his 20th catch of the year. They'll mark him out near the 32-yard line. First down, Pittsburgh in Cincinnati territory, 3 minutes in. Bill Stull, 10th in the country in pass efficiency, much improved over a year ago. He was booed in the first game of the season here at home, but he has won over these Pittsburgh fans with a performance this year that's been remarkably consistent from start to finish, according to the coaches. Coming off, though, perhaps his worst game in their last outing at West Virginia, only their second loss of the year. Lewis, nine more, down to the 23. And Matt, that was the game plan. Frank Cignetti, the offensive coordinator, said, I will be very disappointed if we cannot run the football against this team.
And the guy they're going to have to rely on, obviously, is Lewis, but then it's also that left side. They like their left side of their offensive line. Jason Pinkston, 77, Joe Thomas, their left guard, and the Polish plow when he's in there, number 37, Hank Hynoski. That kid's he's a tough one.
He's the fullback.
There he is.
A bruising fullback at 260 pounds. He was a great tailback in high school, rushed for more than 7,000 yards. Lewis stopped for no gain. Good penetration by Dan Giordano, redshirt freshman out of Frankfort, Illinois, a backup, but Bobby Diaco will rotate liberally in those three front defensive line spots.
Well, I told you about Derek Wolf, the nose tackle, 95. This is the other kid. He does a nice job. He's got good movement, a redshirt freshman, like you said. Not a real big kid, kind of linear, but he has good movement, and his initial get off is where he wins.
Another third down and one. And it's Lewis, and he is short of the first down, trying to follow the fullback, Hynoski. And again, good penetration. Andre Revels coming up from his linebacker spot. David Walker, the running back coach. And Dave Wanstedt decides we're going for it.
That's a good move by Wanstedt right there. And this is the chance for him to show this offensive line to get physical. And also on the flip side, this is the time for Cincinnati to say, hey, we're not going to be shoved around today.
Lewis has handled the ball on every play of this opening possession. Six runs and a pass reception. On fourth and one, first big play of this title game, Lewis has the first down. And spins to the 19-yard line. 4-yard gain. Dave Wanstedt says we're not a fancy new age offense. It is traditional, old-fashioned power football in the pit image.
Watch right there. See that? That's what I'm talking about. That's Dominique Battle has a clean shot. This should be a loss. Instead, he does his Sanders. That's the stuff. I'm sorry, people. I get excited about that. You do not see that stuff, and it is rare for anybody, much less a freshman.
I think we've heard during the year the high regard in which you hold Barry Sanders.
I think
you do not throw those comparisons around lightly.
I think he's the best runner ever.
And here comes Lewis for 10 more near another first down at the 9-yard line. He's working on a streak of 6 straight 100-yard games. He's had 8 100-yard games in the first 11. Drew Fry made the tackle.
One of the things he does very well is he stays patient. And he stays with his blockers. He doesn't leave them all the time. I mean, he knows when the fight is over, that's when he'll get out. But he will follow his blocking, very patient, very, very good discipline.
He still has handled the ball on every play for Pittsburgh. On second and short, first down. And the other remarkable statistic, he hasn't lost a fumble this year. And he came into today with 250 carries and the 19 receptions.
Here's what I want to tell all you high school players out there, kids getting ready to play and would have dreams of college football, don't give up on it. Keep working at them. This guy here was the 150th ranked running back in the state of New Jersey alone. Everybody passed over him. The way they found him is remarkable, so don't give up on your dream.
Here comes Lewis again. Inside the 5. He's from Albany, New York. He went to Blair Academy, a prep school in New Jersey, to try to get more exposure to college football recruiters. And even with 2 years at Blair and some eye-popping numbers, the only other FBS schools he was getting interest from were Miami of Ohio, Temple, and Tulane. Dave Wanstead's assistant Jeff Halfley brought him a tape of Lewis. Dave said, I watched 5 plays and said, give him a scholarship. 12th play of the drive. Lewis again, touchdown.
They said they needed to ride Deion Lewis. They went out and handed him the ball and rode Deion Lewis, and the defense couldn't do anything about it. That is a huge positive for the Pitt Panthers.
And they used more than half of the clock in the first quarter. Dan Hutchins for the extra point. And Pittsburgh leads 7-0. A 4-yard run. He ran for 51 yards on that drive and had a reception for the other 5. Plays 56 yards, 6.5 minutes, all of it from Deion Lewis, who's now scored 90 points as a freshman. That ties LeSean McCoy's Pitt single season record for scoring by a freshman. He's also tied McCoy's freshman rushing touchdown record with 14 and McCoy's total touchdown record as a freshman with 15. And when you're on a list with or above McCoy, Dorsett, and Fitzgerald, you're doing something.
Not too shabby. That's a good group they got right there. And Dave Wanstead knows it. That staff knows it. Tony Wise, the offensive line coach. All he said to me yesterday was, you just watch. Tell me what you think after the game.
Cincinnati went 3 and out, then Pittsburgh kept it for 6.5 minutes. Cincinnati scores quickly. Gilliard brought it back to the 33, and let's go back to the touchdown.
Yeah, it's just a power. This is just simple stuff. Watch Dave Wanstead's group. He's just going to pull them around. They're going to double down and then lead with Hynoski inside. And so they do a nice job. That's Joe Thomas who's going to pull. Hauser's the center. Malecki, the right guard. Nix. And then in the middle, Hynoski, the fullback. They just clear a hole. So it's simple. If you're Deion Lewis, you just go ahead and run to the open. He get to the next level, and he ran through the safety and was 6. Well blocked.
Just about a perfect start for Coach Wanstead. His defense got the 3 and out against this prolific Bearcat offense, and the offense plowed down the field. Mike out throwing to Ben Gadouli, coming off the best day of his career against Illinois last week. 7 catches for the tight end last week for 149 yards and 2 touchdowns.
Yeah, Gadouli's one of those guys that understands zones very, very well. Sits down in the holes of the zones very, very well.
They'll go quickly, as is their custom. Brian Kelly calls the plays. He wants a quick pace. Here's Isaiah Pede showing his maneuverability down the far sideline. And a big gainer for Cincinnati. Out at the 19, they'll mark it at the 18-yard line.
They get you spread. They force you to have to defend the whole field. Boy, is that's a nice block right there inside. And then Pede just handles it, gets to the right sideline before Jared Holley is able to stick him out down to that right side. But Jason Kelce, the guard, did just a fantastic job of clearing that thing.
Pede adding to his team high rushing total. 40-yard run. And Ricky Gary, the backup cornerback, is injured. Junior from Pahokee, Florida, who has started a couple of times this year when Aaron Berry, their outstanding cornerback, was out with a shoulder injury. That included last week at West Virginia. Berry did not play, so Gary started in his spot.
And this Pitt defense, they've, like, there's a bunch of guys banged up back there. They need as many of that of the corner types as they can, especially against this offense. You know, at one point, this Pitt defense is going to have to match up man-to-man. And that's what Brian Kelly was talking about. And he had anticipated some of that. You're watching right here, number 26, as he cuts back here against Pede. This must have fallen kind of weird, maybe a shoulder or something, who knows.
Missed a tackle that could have prevented the big gain. Looks like he injured his arm or shoulder in the process. Now here comes Cincinnati. Quick strike offense. They average only about 26 minutes a game, time of possession. But that doesn't matter. Pike the play action fake. Armon Bins down at the 6-yard line with another first down for UC. 12-yard gain. Aaron Berry made the tackle.
Take a good look at Tony Pike, and they spread the field all over the place, but down here in the red zone, deadly. 15 touchdown passes, and that's as good as it gets.
Best in the country, Pike in the red zone. And Pittsman, one of the best red zone defenses in the country, and that pass is incomplete off the hands of Isaiah Pede. In fact, Pitt is the best red zone defense in the Big East and 10th in the country, so something has to give.
But watch Pete right here. And this is completely on him. He does get his head turned around, doesn't get his hands up quick enough, but that should have been 6.
And he's a good receiver, has 17 catches on the year. They'll throw it around all over the place. Second and goal, Cincinnati looking for a tying touchdown.
Look, you got 3-on-3 up top. That's something the offense would like to have. It looks like they're matching it up now. They're going to be man. Looks like it's man coverage.
Pike might be changing the play, and the clock's at 2 as they snap it. Throws back corner to the end zone. Incomplete. Intended for DJ Woods. And it was broken up by Jared Holley, the redshirt freshman safety, who started the year as their 5th quarterback and has made a very nice transition to safety.
Watch Jared Holley. First of all, very, very bright player. And then what he does so well, and that should have been 6.
Yeah.
But what he does well, he never makes mistakes.
You wonder if the pressure of the big game bothering some of these Bearcats. 2 drop balls here. And now 3rd down and goal. Pike under pressure throws. Flag down. Incomplete pass. But DJ Woods is going to get the flag for interference. He had Elijah Fields on him.
That DJ Woods is another guy who's just, he's on the front end of it. That kid's a pretty good player.
Very highly recruited player.
Pass interference. Defense, number 4. Foul 3rd in the end zone. By rule, the ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic. First down.
That's Elijah Fields. You're going to watch him up here on the top of your screen. He's going to run right back on the inside here. Yeah, he got a little bit too high. You have to take away the inside.
Pede trying to turn the corner, and he stopped at the line of scrimmage. Adam Gunn, the 6th-year senior, playing in his final home game, 23 years old, suffered a broken neck in the opener last year. He actually went through the senior day exercises, last game of the home season last year, not knowing if he'd ever play again, but he got cleared to play and got an extra year of eligibility, so he's back again. And he's important as their middle linebacker. Second and goal. Ramsey to the other side, touchdown.
So a dose of their own medicine. Cincinnati comes back and runs the power to the other side against this Pitt defense and wins up front. It's just a hat on a hat. And then Ramsey find the hole like Lewis did, and it's 6 points.
Fourth rushing touchdown of the season for the senior from Columbus, Ohio, Jacob Ramsey. And now Jake Rogers to tie it. And this is what we expected. Two of the highest scoring teams in the country, and each with seven on the board. Still a long way to go in the first quarter.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, presented by K Jewelers, the number one jewelry store in America. Nissan Maxima, proud partner of the Heisman Trophy. And Pacific Life, for insurance, annuities, and investments, choose Pacific Life, the power to help you succeed.
Today's senior day, always an emotional day for the Pitt Panthers, 18 seniors, 12 of them starters, playing in the biggest game of their careers. And Dave Wan said it was emotional. We talked to him about this yesterday. He said this was the first class that he recruited top to bottom. And when he was doing that, he was coming off his first year as the head coach, and they went 5-6. But he had to convince these recruits they'd play for championships. They built back the Pitt tradition. They needed to have faith in him. Nate Byam said, we did. He was a very highly recruited player among some of these other seniors. So Dave's delighted that their faith has been rewarded.
Well, let me just say that I think Dave Wannstedt is the perfect head coach for Pittsburgh. Mm-hmm. He grew up here. He understands it. He knows the city inside and out. He knows the state in terms of recruiting, knows what he wants here. This is a hand in glove right here. This guy, I think the world of him. I think he's doing a fantastic job, and I think he's going to get a couple more good recruiting classes, and they're going to be here for a while under Dave Wannstedt.
I love, they love the Wannstedt stash. A lot of signs, a lot of imitators among the fans.
You know, it's called the Wannstedt.
Yes. Jake Rogers kicks off. Cameron Sadler will bring it back. He was the uncle of the former Pittsburgh basketball star DeJuan Blair. Left early and went to the Spurs as a rookie this year. He was tackled by Chris Williams. Tonight at 8 Eastern on ABC, don't miss the Dr. Pepper Big 12 championship game. Heisman candidate Colt McCoy and third-ranked Texas trying to secure their place in the national championship game with a win over the 22nd-ranked Nebraska Cornhuskers. It's championship weekend. Win and you're in. The Dr. Pepper Big 12 championship game tonight at 8 Eastern on ABC.
That one's going to be fun. I'm anxious to see how Ndamukong Suh does against that offensive line.
Leon Lewis. How about that run?
It's unbelievable. I know you're probably getting tired of hearing me talk about this kid. It's only the first quarter. But it's just, this kid's just special. Let's just watch him. You don't have to say a word.
Gain of 7. Second and 3. Yards after contact. Bobby Diaco, the defensive coordinator for Cincinnati, said he has uncommon contact balance. And that's a great way of phrasing it. He has a first down out to the 46. 7 more. Here's Holly.
Well, guys, we're talking about Pitt assistant Jeff Hafley and how he found Deion Lewis. He was a graduate assistant last spring, became promoted to a full-time assistant. So he thought, you know, I have to really do a good job. This is my first recruiting experience. They gave him New Jersey, and he went through all the recruiting lists. He decided he was going to get a tape or information on every single kid on the list. Near the bottom of 150 was Deion Lewis. I'll give you a little more after the snap.
He's still touched the ball on every snap, all 14 of them for Pittsburgh. Run blitz. And Lewis still gets away from that. Looked like they had him stopped to the line. He scored it for five, Holly.
Well, so Jeff Hafley puts in Deion Lewis's tape that Deion himself sent in. And he said, man, am I crazy or is this kid pretty good? So he drove about 2.5 hours out of his way to go and watch Deion in person. He said, if he wasn't 5'4", I was pretty sure we would want him. Jeff Hafley to this day has kept that recruiting list as a lesson to himself. Don't let rankings or ratings change your mind. He knew his eyes when he saw him, and he knew Deion Lewis would be pretty special.
He was dead on.
He's going to get a well-earned breather. Ray Graham, another talented freshman from Elizabeth, New Jersey's in. He goes straight ahead. And he's into Cincinnati territory at the 47. And Jeff Hafley was funny. He said he'd tell other recruiters he's heading to Blair Academy. No, you're not going to see that Lewis kid. He's too small. And Hafley said, yeah, you're right. He's too small.
He's too small. Really, you don't want to look at him. Kid can't play. That's well done, and that, and they found another one. Kid right here, this kid, Ray Graham. He's in New Jersey. His head coach at his high school, Chet Parlavecchio, outstanding coach in New Jersey, said you can't miss with this kid.
Coaches say he is similar talent to Lewis. That's scary. Out in the flat, it's caught. Deion Lewis got one play off. He has the catch. They convert on third down to the 41. And Frank Cignetti, the new offensive coordinator, Matt, talked a lot yesterday about preaching to his team, win the situation. Right? And third and fourth down are some of the situations right. He's talking about. They're winning third and fourth down right now.
Yeah, and what that's Bill Belichick style football. That's where he gets that from. And what they're talking about is, like, if it's third and two, make sure you have the two. Third and eight, make sure you get the sticks. And understand where you are in field position, blitzing tendencies, all that. It's preached here. I think Wannstedt staff does a great job of it.
Another run blitz, and that time Lewis slipped as he tried to make a cut. No gain, perhaps even a loss of a yard. Craig Carey was in the neighborhood. The snow has dissipated. Maybe it flurries most of the morning, and from time to time it strengthened into light snow, but right now nothing.
You watch Craig Carey. See, he does a good job of setting the edge and taking that away. And really, that turf, you know, came up a little bit, but he was tackled more by the 38 or 42 than he was carry.
First carry for a loss of a yard. So Stull's going to throw it. He's going deep. It's well defended, and a battle for the ball. It's incomplete. Intended for Doran Dickerson, the outstanding tight end, with Aaron Webster, the safety, in coverage, and good coverage from the senior safety from Detroit.
Now Dickerson can run. They say he's the fastest player in this field. And he needs to get on top of this. Now he's tracking the ball. He's waiting on it. He's got to go attack the ball. It's kind of a little free-for-all at the end of that. Pretty well defended down the field, however. Good job by Webster. He's able to get over the top. He actually came down with the ball. But Dickerson's going to have to go and attack the thing. That's what Baldwin does so well.
Dickerson runs a sub 4.440 at 230 pounds. The players we talked to yesterday insisted he's the fastest man on the team. Stull throws on time, caught. Jonathan Baldwin very near the first down. On third down and 11, Stull a nicely timed throw. The crowd boos as the official moved the ball back just a little bit as he spotted it on the far sideline.
Sean, watch the end of this route. Now this is what we were talking about early in the season. This is kinesthetic sense. Look at the body awareness. That's phenomenal. He throws it to the backside. Some people call that throwing them open, but you can only do that if you have a guy who can be thrown open. Baldwin is unique in that way.
And it was a good spot.
Good spot.
You could see Baldwin extended the ball to the yellow line, but the official moved it back to where he was originally down. And as a result, they're short. Wannstedt went for it on their first drive on a fourth down and got it. And it looks like they're poised to do that again. After a 10-yard completion to Baldwin, another great talent on this offense, Dave Wannstedt, who was the head coach in the NFL with the Bears and Dolphins, since Baldwin's going to be a first-round pick.
Baldwin, if I were playing Baldwin right now at this point in his career, I would get up and walk up on him and see if he can beat a jam at the line of scrimmage, because he's kind of a long strider. But he's a powerful kid, so you want him to develop in that area.
You would expect Lewis following Hynoski. On fourth down and very short, Lewis follows the fullback, first down. to the 28-yard line of Cincinnati. 1 minute to go in an electric first quarter with the Big East Championship and a BCS Bowl bid up for grabs.
Watch 27 right there. You just stay behind him at 74, Malecki. Nice job also in terms of blocking there. Number two does a great job. That's Doran Dickerson, the tight end. And then the rest just let the kid run.
Lewis has picked up all seven Pitt first downs. Here they come to blitz him again. And that's dangerous. As he gets through that line of scrimmage, he's off to the races. But they respond well. Short gain of three. Aaron Webster, the senior safety, made the tackle. That might be the final play of the quarter. And it will be.
But Sean, this is exactly what the Pittsburgh Panthers wanted to be able to do. Control the ball, keep that Cincinnati offense on the other sideline, and let the clock run down and get a six at the end of it.
And Pittsburgh had the ball for over 11 and a half minutes in that first quarter, but Brian Kelly's been there before. It's still a 7-7 game. On a cold and snowy day in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, college football presented by K Jewelers. Cincinnati and Pittsburgh battling for the Big East Conference Championship and the league's automatic bid into a BCS Bowl. 7-7 game as the second quarter begins with Pitt second and seven at the Cincinnati 25. Leon Lewis heaved for three. Tackled by Andre Rebels. We look at the Pacific Life game summary. Statistically, Pittsburgh at 99 yards and over 11 and a half minutes in time of possession. Lewis now 18 carries already.
18 carries but what on the flip side, you see what they did on the other side, because now Isaiah Pede, you know, he had the big run. And they, like you said, Sean, they can score quickly. Still look at the end of the first and all the unbalance of the number with the time of possession.
Stull going deep to the end zone on third and four. It's caught but incomplete, out of bounds. Jonathan Baldwin well covered by Dominique Battle, and the field goal unit will come out for Pittsburgh.
Well, he had possession and he had the catch. Battle works on him. There it is. That is touchdown.
That's a touchdown.
That's 6 points.
And I would think that they would review that. Left foot down. Looked like he had the ball
all the way. That's 6 points. You got to be kidding me.
Yeah, they should take their time on this field goal.
They got to be kidding.
Yeah, here comes the buzz from the replay booth.
The previous play is under further review.
This is another example, Sean, of what we were talking about in terms of body part awareness. That's just great athleticism, and a lot of times you have guys who are great athletes, but they don't have complete control where everything is, especially in the air. Watch this. There's the catch. Get the foot down, secure the catch. That's 6 points.
Guess the only question is, when does he really have possession of the ball?
He plucks it right there. He's pulling it down.
It looks like he has it possessed the entire time.
Right. Yeah, that's six.
Nicholas Trainer is the replay official. I will say this, in recent years I've been very impressed. I think the Big East officiating is as good as any conference that we travel around to on a regular basis. Terry McCauley, the NFL referee, is the Big East supervisor of officials, and he has done a great job with this group.
Terry does a great job. In fact, as an official himself, I love the way he calls the next level game. Because he's in control, and that's what he preaches with these officials.
At the further review, it was determined that the receiver's left foot came down inbounds. They had possession. Touchdown.
Well done. That's how replay is supposed to work.
You know, Sean lost it all, the Baldwin talk. Stull threw a heck of a throw. I mean, that was a small window throw, and he got it in there. Well protected, step and throw, exactly what you want to see from your quarterback.
His 20th touchdown pass of his senior season. Seventh TD reception for Baldwin, 22 yards. They've had two possessions. They've had two 12-play touchdown drives. And the extra point good by Dan Hutchins. Bill Stull booed the first game of the season. He's the toast of Pittsburgh at the end of his senior season. Sean McDonough, Matt Millen, Holly Rowe back in Pittsburgh. Donovan Baldwin with the touchdown that has given Pittsburgh the lead again.
Watch Lewis first. You have to be able to block if you're going to play running back. Boom. It's all right to get run over. Just don't let him get to the cue. Now they give him a two-tier read. He has Dickerson underneath, and he knows he has Baldwin man-to-man. That's pretty well covered down the field. Does a nice job, though, putting it in the small window, and Battle can't quite get to it. Baldwin comes down with six.
Luke breaks to kick off to Darren Williams and Marty Gilliard. And it'll come down to Williams. And he slides to the 23-yard line. Let's check in now with Matt Weiner in New York.
Hello, Sean. I'll have all the plays that define this championship Saturday, including the Conference USA title game in East Carolina.
The Pirates are trying to repeat as CUSA champs. Seven-all game, Houston's Case Keenum to James Cleveland. Keenum's 40th touchdown pass of the season. PAT no good, 13-7 Houston.
All right, Matt, thank you. Cincinnati on offense. We haven't said that often. They've had 3 minutes and 14 seconds time of possession. The game is almost 16 minutes old, but there you go. They average 26 and 5 seconds time of possession per game. So basically every game they're out time of possession by 7 minutes. But they've scored more than 200 points more than their opponents this year. Isaiah P. stopped by Miles Carrigine.
Think about that, though, Sean, what you're talking about. They score tons of points. They don't hold the ball long. This is an efficient offense. They move up and down the field at a fast pace, and they eat up a lot of yardage.
Their average scoring drive takes under 7 plays and lasts 2 minutes and 23 seconds. Here's P trying to bounce away and does. That looked like Deion Lewis. 2-yard gain. Here's Holly.
Guys, just for those of you not familiar with the story, Tony Pike, the quarterback of Cincinnati, had surgery about 4 weeks ago to adjust a protective plate that was in his arm after he broke his arm last year. But what doctors found is he had actually refractured that arm. He's back just 4 weeks later. He had an incision wrist to elbow. He's got one small protective pad on it right now, guys.
He was a Heisman Trophy candidate before he went out for nearly 4 games. Good throw and a catch. Armand Benz had single coverage and defeated it from Giovanni Chappelle. They'll mark the ball near the 44-yard line. First down Cincinnati on a 31-yard play.
Here's the key. He has time. He can see the whole field. No pressure. Well protected. And then he gets on top down below Benz and comes down with the catch.
And they come up quickly, and Pike fires another bullet to Marty Gilliard. And he's down at the 37-yard line, tackled by Jared Holly. And Pike really wants to accelerate the tempo for Coach Kelly.
Yeah, this is what they do really well. This is fun to watch.
Pike, he has great escapability at 6'6", and now he has Gilliard in space. And a good tackle in the open field by Aaron Berry. But Gilliard got inside the 20, another first down, and here they come quickly to the line after an 18-yard gain.
This is what we were talking about with Pike that people forget about. He's 6'6", he can stay in the pocket, but this kid can move, and he throws on the run well. You get Gilliard in space, forget it, that kid's special.
Well, look at Pike's numbers, and if you could add 3 more games of stats, he'd be right there among the leading Heisman candidates. Empty backfield. They send four wide receivers out, and the pass intended for Gilliard is broken up by Jared Holley. And there's a flag down. It was actually intended for DJ Woods. Dom DeCicco, the safety, doesn't like the call.
Well, Holley makes a fantastic play. It looks like they're going to call it on DeCicco. Remember, Holley is a corner playing safety. He has corner skills.
After the play, personal foul, defense, high hit, at the distance of the goal, automatic, first down.
Watch DeCicco, number 31 there in your screen. He'll come in, and they're saying that he went too high on the hit. Holley, perfect position. It's helmet to helmet.
And that is a major point of emphasis this year, and there's no doubt about that call.
Yeah,
the fans
call.
Are booing, but they got it right.
I mean, those are the rules. That's the way they're calling the games now. And once you tell the rule and guys understand it, you play by it.
DeCicco, hey, though, says DeCicco's a linebacker playing safety.
And he is. He's a big kid. You put the tape on, you're like, I said to Dave, how big is that 31? He said, oh, he's about 230 pounds. He really should be playing linebacker.
They needed a safety, so he's moved there and played well. First and goal, Cincinnati from the 9, looking for a tying touchdown early in the second quarter. Pike, one-on-1 coverage, far side, out of bounds, flag down. Giovanni Chappelle with tight coverage and perhaps too tight on Armon Bins.
Pass interference. Defense, number 7. The foul occurred in the end zone. By rule, the ball will be put at the 2-yard line. Automatic, first down.
Watch Chappelle, number 7, takes away the inside. That's what you want.
Wow.
I don't see it.
No, I don't either.
And that looked to me like it's pretty good defense.
Well, you get a little frisky there at the very end. And the unfortunate thing for Dave Wanstead and Pitt was it probably wasn't going to be catchable in bounds anyway.
You know what I don't like about that, Dave? I saw a picture of Wanstead. There's no penalty for frisky. Mm-hmm. It's got to be interference. I didn't see it.
Play action, roll out for Pike, throws on the run low, incomplete. DeCicco had the coverage on Kazim Ali, one of the two tight ends you see along with Ben Gadouli.
That's pretty well defense there by the left defensive end, Jabal Sheard. Because if he doesn't give any pressure, then Pike's going to take it himself.
Second and goal, Cincinnati at the 2. Gilliard, the motion man. Pike, fake the one direction, throws back, and it is short. And a play that looked to be open and just wasn't executed. Elijah Fields had the coverage.
That's the old roll to the right and come back to the left. It's a delay. They'll fall down. The tight end will fall down. That's Travis Kelce, and he'll fall. You'll see him right there. You see him? He falls down, and then Fields, sometimes what you do as a defender, you think, oh, he's on the ground. Forget it. I'll go help someplace else. He comes to the backside, and Pike can't quite get the ball there because DeCicco was putting pressure on him.
And with a big third and goal upcoming, Brian Kelly will use a timeout. All season long, we've been counting down college football's top 30 moments of the last 30 years. When we come back, we'll reveal moment number 4.
Buffalo Wild Wings presents the top 30 plays of the last 30 years. 4. After a hook and ladder allowed Boise State to send the game into overtime, they pulled out the Statue of Liberty to defeat Oklahoma. Quarterback Jared Zabransky faked the pass and handed off to running back Ian Johnson, who ran it in and finished the fairy tale with a proposal.
Yes!
Follow the top 30 countdown all season long. Brought to you by Buffalo Wild Wings.
Memorable play, and Chrissy Popadick said yes. Be sure to tune in to ABC's College Football later this afternoon. The Arizona-USC game, they'll reveal moment number 3. Here's another big moment in this game. Pittsburgh leading by a touchdown. Third and goal, Cincinnati looking for the tying score. They're at the 2-yard line.
Keep your eye on Isaiah Pede. Right there.
Pike throws a quick pass, batted up in the air, and incomplete. Jabal Sheard deflected it. Looked like Max Gruder had a great chance to intercept it, but couldn't field that high pop-up. They do a good job batting down passes. Brian Kelly said that he wasn't as concerned today about that because his quarterback is 6'6".
Sheard, he faked like he was going to drop and then came and got his hands up. Now, that's, you know, the difference between a good play and a great play is the interception. And Gruder had an opportunity for a great one.
Jake Rogers picks a 20-yard field goal from a tough angle. Three more for Cincinnati. 76-yard drive ends in three. It almost ended in disaster for the Bearcats.
College football presented by Kate Jewelers, brought to you by Aflac. We've got you under our way. And Flip Video. Do you flip?
They flip, and for Cincinnati, relatively, by their standards, time-consuming drive. 3 minutes and 1 second. It resulted in a Jake Rogers field goal. Mentioned Tony Pike, the most efficient quarterback in the country in the red zone. But today, one out of six in the red zone. They've been helped by the fact that there have been three pass interference penalties.
Pitt defense, as you said, they're top in the country, like number, they're in the top 10 in red zone defense. They've been playing good red zone defense.
Cameron Sadler from the 8-yard line has a hole and brings it out to the 37. Here's Holly.
Well, guys, the snow continues here, and it's really making the surface very slick right now. You saw Tony Pike just slip in the red zone. We've already seen a number of the Pitt players change out their shoes, and look how Tim Enright, the Pitt equipment guy, has this organized pretty good. All right, Doran Dickerson, you need to change your shoes to the detachable cleats. Here they are. They're a little bit longer, firmer cleat. They're wearing the Nikes, guys, and they're just trying to get more sure footing because as it continues to snow, things are getting pretty slick.
And they'll go to the 5/8, Holly. That's what they go from, half to 5/8. You can get to 3/4, but those, they're usually a little too uncomfortable, so you stick with the 5/8 with stuff like this.
Play action pass for Stahl, has a receiver and a first down to the Cincinnati 40. Mike Shanahan, no relation to the former Denver Bronco coach of the same name, tackled by Webster, and it's a 23-yard pickup.
And nice protection, and you have to, again, you're going to play running back, you're Ray Graham, you better get that block. And that allows him to just step and throw. Nice, under control, and the ball's where it has to be. And here comes Shanahan.
And it's the formula for Frank Cignetti that he talked about yesterday. Establish the run to set up the play action pass. Only 10 catches for Shanahan. He was injured at the beginning of the year. Flea flicker, Stahl going deep, looking for Baldwin. Touchdown!
Sean, they use the play action to set up the deep stuff, and here it comes right down the middle. Throw it up and let Baldwin go get it. Ryan Kelly was afraid that Baldwin could do this to the secondary.
This second touchdown catch of the day. Three possessions, three touchdowns for Pittsburgh, and Dan Hutchins, another extra point. 40-yard reception by Baldwin, who's been a big play receiver all year. He's had at least one reception of 40 yards now in 8 games this year, including this one. And here's a look at today's City Inside View.
It all starts up front, and they're going to take the fake inside, and that will draw. They're going to blitz anyway, but that draws everybody in. But I want you to watch the safety. See what he does. He slows down right there. See him? Stop. Now Baldwin just gets on his horse, and that's Drew Fry, 26. Actually, the ball is a little underthrown, but Baldwin is able to come back. Maybe a little bit of a little push in there. comes down with the ball at six quick.
And if you're a Cincinnati fan, you have to be concerned about the defense. Brian Kelly, when we visited the other day, said he thinks they've gotten a little bit worn down here late in the year. But over the last three games, they give up 45 points to Connecticut, 21 to West Virginia, 36 last week to Illinois. That's an average of 33 points per game allowed in the last three, and they've already yielded 21, not yet 5 minutes into the second quarter. Luke Briggs to kick off. The snow starting to come down a little harder. Marty Gilliard. Chopped down at the 28-yard line. Giovanni Chappelle with good coverage for the Panthers.
Well, this is what Cincinnati, they're not unfamiliar. They know they can score quick. And they know they need to sustain some things also. They need to give their defense, because you mentioned it, Sean, the defense getting a little tired here. And so they need to give their defense a rest, let them collect on the sideline. Pike's the guy who can do it.
Five wide receivers, four to Pike's left. Four-man rush, and they got plenty of pressure on him. I think that's one of the remarkable things about this defense, coordinated by Phil Bennett. They lead the country in sacks, Matt, and largely they do it with a four-man rush. They're not a big blitz team.
Yeah, watch Williams right inside. He's just going to go against that left, that right guard. It's not even close. He just goes right around him. That's Alex Hoffman, right guard, 59. Hoffman starts to lose his feet. You saw he started to slip, along with Holly saying they're going to have to probably check their spikes as well. But Williams with that just quick inside move on the isolation.
Bill Bennett was excited about this game. He felt they should have won the Big East Championship last year. Pike finds somewhere to throw it. It's Ben Gadooly. But little room. He got to the 30 for about a yard and a half before he was driven back by Giovanni Chappelle.
Give Pike a little bit of time. He's going to find some things down the field. The ball comes out very quickly. He has a good release. Right now, that Pitt defensive line is really getting off the ball. It looks now like they may be going the three-man rush and dropping eight, unless they bring an extra guy. There's Romeus 91 and Sheard on the other side. Three-man rush.
And it is a passive rush, and Pike throws on the run! Intercepted! Tom DeCicco, the safety.
They rush the three. Pike scrambles out to his right. And then they actually do bring down the fourth. It looks like it's Gruder who gets a little pressure. And watch DeCicco. Just runs right through the receiver. And that's Gallooly. Looks like he may have got a little push there to Gadooly.
Gadooly certainly went sprawling. Pike's last six passes, four incompletions, one interception among the six. Just the fourth pick thrown this year by Pike. Cincinnati with Pike and Zach Collaris have led the nation in passing efficiency this year. There's Deion Lewis powering for five. Fourth possession for Pittsburgh. They've scored touchdowns on each of their first three. Andre Rebels made the tackle.
John, this is where that Pitt offensive line, with their size, this is where they can start to make some hay. They like the inside three of those guys. Joe Thomas, the left guard, and Hauser, the center, Malecki. They have some size in there. There's a couple of defensive mentalities in there, especially 74. Malecki, he was a defender, but he likes to put his head on you.
Started his career as a defensive lineman. Lewis bottled up after a short gain. It'll bring up a third down and two tonight at 8 Eastern on ESPN. Championship weekend continues with the Dr. Pepper ACC Championship. 10th-ranked Georgia Tech taking on Clemson for the ACC crown and a berth in a BCS bowl. That's the Dr. Pepper ACC Championship game tonight, 8 Eastern on ESPN.
We had Georgia Tech last week, and if Josh Nesbitt doesn't get an ankle or even hold on to the ball at the end of the game, who knows where that thing goes.
Big third down and two. Lewis breaks tackles. Ball came out. And it went out of bounds. We mentioned he hasn't lost a fumble all year, and he still hasn't lost one. Was swatted out by Aaron Webster.
First down. Remember, Sean, in a fumble like that, if it goes forward, it comes back to where he releases the ball if it goes out of bounds. And if it goes backwards, then it stays there. He's been pretty good holding on to the ball.
He might have recovered it before it went over the boundary.
He does a good job of switching the ball and keeping it on the outside hand. Cincinnati did a good job of knocking it away there.
These are two of the best teams in the country in terms of fewest turnovers. Lewis with plenty of lead blockers. Leaps to the 24, perhaps even the 23. Dominique Battle credited with the tackle, but that's 15 more for Lewis. First down, Pittsburgh on the move again.
It's just a nice job of the offensive line, and then Hynoski, watch 27. Boom. In fact, Hynoski, he's going to put a block on the guy, slips and falls, and if he doesn't get out of the way, heck, Lewis might still be running.
Lewis is over 100 yards now, 22 carries, 104 yards, a seventh straight 100-yard game. High formation with two tight ends, and Cincinnati says enough of that. Ricardo Matthews, a senior, he's come out of nowhere this year for Cincinnati. Bob Diaco told us he played more snaps in the opener this year than he had played in his entire career.
Yeah, watch Matthews just going to come down inside, and Pinkston can't get to him. Pinkston, that left tackle, he's trying to come down inside, and Matthews with the hard inside moving and up the field. Well done.
Matthews, despite the late start to his collegiate career in terms of getting a lot of playing time, projects, Coach Diaco believes, as an NFL prospect. He's very strong. Thrown out in the flat. Deion Lewis breaks a tackle and is down at the 17-yard line. About 3.5 yards short of the first down. Tripped up by Andre Rebels. And another key play coming up here. There's Bob Diaco. First year at Cincinnati, brought a 3-4 defense. He studied under one of the best in that defense, Al Groh at Virginia, where Diaco was an assistant the last 3 years. Bob says it's part of the Belichick Parcells Groh tree. Stull, 7 out of 8 passing. He hands it off to Lewis. And on third down and about 4, Lewis only got halfway there, and now Dave Wanstead will have a decision to make, and he's not going to waste much time. Championship game, get some more points.
Put the points on the board. Because he knows, if he goes up, this will be a 2-touchdown game. He knows that's not safe. He knows that Cincinnati could make that thing up.
Cincinnati's averaging over 39 points per game. 6th in the country. Hutchins, with Pittsburgh's best marks in Big East Conference play as a field goal kicker, with the 18 makes and 23 tries. And he is right down the middle from 33. The Pike's interception leads to 3 points for Pittsburgh and a 2-touchdown lead for the Panthers. Time to take a look at today's Aflac trivia question. We want to know who is the only man to be the head football coach at both the University of Cincinnati and the University of Pittsburgh. It's great coaches in both places. Of course, Brian Kelly doing things that no coach had ever done. The only coach to have double digits in wins in a season before Brian Kelly at Cincinnati was the Hall of Famer Sid Gilman. Back in the early 50s, Brian's had double figures in wins 3 years in a row. They come here at 11-0 for the first time in school history. But down by 2 touchdowns, under 5 minutes to go, first half. Luke Briggs sends it down to the 1, bobbled for a moment by Marty Gilliard, and he does not make the 20. Chopped down by Jared Holly at the 19.
Well, Tony Pike has had himself a rough day, not because of his throwing, but because the receivers haven't been helping him. Two drop balls in the end zone, and then a little bit of push on the backside for a pick, and it's been slow going for him here early.
Still Pike at quarterback. Zach Kolaris has played very well this year. Had his helmet on during the last TV timeout. Kelly said it is possible we could see Kolaris at least as a changeup at some point today. The screen is buried for a loss. Back of the 15, Peed caught it. Max Gruder caught him.
That's well done by Gruder because he reads it quickly. And the best way to take away a screen is to get on your coverage right away. See how he's tracking him inside out. He knows where Peed is. He stays with them. Jump your coverage.
Gruder, first year starter, has done a nice job. Second leading tackler. Sophomore out of Charlotte, North Carolina. Had 11 tackles in their big win against Notre Dame. Nice call. Inside handoff to Peed. And Gruder took him down again at the 24. It'll be third and five after we check in with Matt Weiner in New York.
All right, John, SportsCenter right now is presented by Best Buy in the Conference USA Championship game. Case Keenan, we show you his 40th touchdown pass. That's just his seventh interception of the year and has led seven plays later to a Giovanni Ruffin touchdown run. The Pirates of East Carolina, 14-13.
All right, Matt, thank you. Here it's 24-10 Pittsburgh. Big third down. Pike the pump fake, and he can run. Needs the 29 and has it. Out of bounds at the 30. First down, Cincinnati, 3.5 to go. First half.
Good awareness by Pike, knows what he has, and knows what the sticks are. This is the situational stuff we were talking about early. He just pulls it down, has the green, knows where to get to.
Bearcats have won 11 straight Big East games. They've won 8 straight road games. Incomplete pass in the direction of Marty Gilliard.
They did something interesting there. They took Kerrigan, the defensive lineman, and ran him inside out looking for any crossers. It happened to be Gilliard, and he ran him right over.
Miles Carrigan's a sophomore from right here in Pittsburgh. Pike fake the handoff, rolls, throws deep, looking for Armand, bends, and no flag. Good coverage by Giovanni Chappelle, and a good battle between Chappelle and Benz.
Armand Benz gets on top, but I want you to watch Chappelle at the end of this route. Watch his eyes. He goes from his hips to his eyes. Keeps his hand, watch right there. He looks, when he looks, then he turns, watch his eyes, he looks. When Ben's eyes get big, you turn and make a play.
Pike, 2 for his last 9 passing for minus 1 yard. Third down and 10. They've been a great third down team all year, averaging over 8 yards per third down play. Best in the nation. And that's an incomplete pass. And it would have been short of the first down anyway. Would have got them that 8 they're averaging instead of the 10 they needed. Benz broken up by Chappelle again.
Boy, Sean, it's the Chappelle show here. And this isn't funny. This play, this guy is playing tremendous. Watch this. This is a good player. This Benz is a good player. Chappelle, nice job with the top side and then defends on the inside. That's fantastic.
Chappelle had his hands on Benz. Blocked. It's blocked. The punt is blocked. Rogers buried at the 3. Nate Nix blocked it. Dave Wunsch that said yesterday, we're going to come after the punter. We think we can get one. Last year against Cincinnati, they blocked a field goal and a punt, and they blocked another. 25-yard difference in field position.
Right on the inside. Take a good look at him. Watch Nix. And you saw Brian Kelly on the side saying, hey, that's one guy. He ran right through the shield, ran right through the up back, got his hand up. Actually, that's a low trajectory off that kick. But Nix gets his hand up and puts the Panthers on the 5-yard line.
Well, a huge play by Nix. And now Pittsburgh late in the half. Chance to take a 3-score lead. First and goal from the 5. And Lewis tackled by Webster after a gain of about a yard.
John talking to Dave Wannstedt when he was talking about this, and you know, we're not very good in the return game. So instead of taking our chances of trying to return the ball, we're just going to go ahead and try to block it, like you said, and they came through. That's a great effort.
Last year they led the nation in block kicks. They had 10. This year only 3. Lewis stuffed at the line of scrimmage. J.K. Schaefer, the sophomore inside linebacker, just a 19-year-old true sophomore. In the words of Bob Diaco, a tough Cincinnati kid, he made a big play there.
And has good instincts, and he finds the ball pretty well. And that's what this defense is doing right now. And they're daring the Panthers to go ahead and throw the football, because they're going to take away Deion Lewis with everything. They had been playing with 2 safeties deep, and obviously they're down inside the 5, and they're stacking the deck.
Third and goal. Will it be more power football? No. Play action pass by Stull. Pump fake. Runs for the pylon. Touchdown.
Like we just said, they were daring them to throw. So they went with the play action and they used Stull's feet. They got him on the edge, and then there was Green, he just took it. But because of the coverage down the field, there was no defender out there, and Stull had 6.
And Cincinnati doing things that it has not done all season long. The turnover by Pike, the interception was just the 8th turnover of the year for Cincinnati, still fewest in the country. And the block punt was the first the Bearcats have had blocked this season. It led to a touchdown run by Stull, his 2nd of the year. 3 touchdown lead for the Panthers. Dave Wannstedt says Bill Stull's had an amazing senior season. He was horrible, in the words of Wannstedt, in their bowl game last year. They were shut out 3-0 in the Sun Bowl by Oregon State, and the quarterback job was thrown wide open. Stull had to compete against 2 other candidates in the spring. He took as many reps in the spring with the 3rd team as he did with the 1st team. Even through the summer, he still wasn't clearly number 1. They went with him because he was good, not great in the preseason, but once the year began, he has been terrific, and his touchdown run has given them a 21-point lead. Luke Briggs kickoff. Here comes Marty Gilliard. Free at last.
Here's the angle.
They have the angle, and that's their only chance of getting them, and they will not. Touchdown, Marty Gilliard. 2nd kickoff return for a score in as many weeks. This one, 99 yards.
Gilliard has the speed to be able to do that, and he can outrun angles, and he has great vision, but you can't get to the open ground, and you only do that with great run skills. And then watch him just go down that left side. One guy to beat, and he beat him.
Buddy Jackson had the chance for Pittsburgh. 5th career return score by Marty Gilliard. He was the special teams player of the year last year in the Big East. And that's his school record 4th career kickoff return for a touchdown. Cincinnati right back in it as we approach halftime. The senior Marty Gilliard with a huge play for Cincinnati. Kickoff return for a touchdown to get them back within 2 scores, 1:10 to go. in the first half. His story's been well chronicled. Out of school for a while, lost his scholarship, academic issues. For a while was homeless, living out of his car, worked four different jobs to support himself, got his academic house in order, back in the program, and one of the very best players in the country right now.
Well, he just said, hey, listen, we're down. I'm going to take the whole team and put them on my shoulders, and he carried them for 100 yards. As he just pulled the Cincinnati team right back into it.
Special teams disaster on the block punt, and followed by the kickoff return for a score, and there's a special teams problem again for Pittsburgh. Cameron Sadler dropped the ball, and it went out of bounds at the 8.
It was going to go out of bounds regardless. You should just let it go and get the ball in the 40.
And now you'd have to think, with this field position, and with Pittsburgh leading by 2 touchdowns, they'll be very conservative here.
See how the ball was trailing to his left? He was standing right on the sideline. Look at this. Just let it go. It's going out of bounds. That's going to be out to the 40-yard line. Instead, that's a 27-yard difference.
So now he does have 2 timeouts left here in the half. Of course, Deion Lewis can change field position. There's another fumble that goes out of bounds. But when you haven't lost the fumble all year, you need some good fortune. And he's had it a couple of times. He's put it on the deck twice now. That time, Aaron Webster popped it out.
Yeah, Webster says, so you think you're pretty good with the ball in your hands? Let me show you what I can do. Watch it. Pow! Right on the ball. Webster just tracks him. See him from the top of your screen. He's got to come from the right. Right. Boom. Right there. And you're right. He was lucky. It went out of bounds.
And perhaps a break for Cincinnati because it stopped the clock. They're thinking about getting the ball back down by 2 scores with their quick strike capability. Lewis out to the 17-yard line, the 18-yard line, and a timeout is called. Cincinnati called it, leaving the Bearcats with 1. Curtis Young made the tackle. Good day for the Duck, looking at that camera lens. The answer to today's Affleck trivia question: who's the only person to be the head football coach at both Cincinnati and Pittsburgh? It's one of the nicest people we know. Mike Gottfried, our longtime colleague at ABC and ESPN, coached at Cincinnati and Pittsburgh, and is now doing great work in communities throughout the country with Team Focus, mentoring fatherless young boys all over America. Not only an outstanding coach, he's an even better person and a wonderful broadcaster for so many years on these airwaves.
Doesn't get any better than that. That's as good a person as you're going to find. And he was a good person in the beginning of Cincinnati, all through Pitt, and he still is.
And Lewis is stuffed.
Good defense.
That was his 29th carry of the half. He got blown up by Drew Fry. You would say fried him. I'll steal that from you. And timeout, Cincinnati. So it looked like they might be heading to the locker room down 31-10. The kickoff return got them to within 14. Momentum clearly on Brian Kelly's side right now. Of course, he has been mentioned prominently in all the rumors surrounding the vacant Notre Dame head football coaching job. Logical that he would be a candidate given his outstanding resume, 2 national championships at Division II Grand Valley State, where he's a head coach for 13 years. He went to Central Michigan 3 years there, won a Mid-American Conference title. 3 seasons at Cincinnati, unprecedented success with the Bearcats. And it doesn't hurt at Notre Dame to be named Brian Kelly.
Yeah, how about it? It's a fine day we are here for the Irish.
He's not going to speak to Notre Dame until after this game. He promised the Cincinnati folks he would. He said if they want to talk then, we will. Dan Hutchins punts. When it was 31-10, I'm sure some of the fans might have been wondering, you know, was that all a distraction? He says it has not been the least bit of a distraction to his players. He said all they care about is where's the meal.
Personal foul. Defense, number 15. 15-yard penalty from the end of the punt. First down.
Boy, from bad to worse, Shane Murray called for a personal foul and then getting an earful from Dave Wanstead. Short punt, 35 yards. Off the foot of Hutchins, and then the personal foul against Murray, who either doesn't like the call or doesn't like the earful from the coach, or both.
That's a feisty punter. I've never seen one of them. Even if he didn't punt, that's a feisty punter.
Feisty coverage guy. Boy, has the situation brightened considerably for Cincinnati here in the last 30 seconds of game action. On the run, it's intercepted. Pike throwing on the run, then knocks Elijah Fields out of bounds to save a touchdown. But just when UC had momentum, Pike threw it away to Elijah Fields.
Elijah Fields is just in the slot, and he's reading Pike the whole way. Watch him right here. His eyes are back inside. It's zone coverage. He feels it. Now watch the break. Gadooly thinks he has it. Fields takes it the other way. Now watch Pike. He saves a touchdown. Pike is eyeballing him the whole time. That's just good football all the way around. A poor throw, a decision, but Fields does a nice job of reading it and making the break on Gadooly.
Cincinnati had had only 7 turnovers all season, fewest in the nation. Pike's thrown 2 interceptions. Stahl comes out slinging, and he's intercepted. Here come the Bearcats the other way. Aaron Webster's had a terrific first half for a defense that's been under siege. Tackled by Mike Shanahan. Time left for Cincinnati with 24 seconds to go.
this is unbelievable. This is a great job also by Webster. Now watch him on the top side. They're going to make this throw as he comes back and goes across the motion. Stahl thinks he has a shot. Another great job of eyeballing the quarterback and making the break on the throw. Webster sees it the whole time and takes it the other way.
His 4th interception of the season, and a pep talk for Pike. He needs to revert back to Tony Pike form. 31-yard return. Pike under duress, escapes. No timeouts for Cincinnati. Throws it up, one-on-one coverage. Legs tangle and no flags. Marty Gilliard, the intended receiver, and Aaron Berry had the coverage. Phil Bennett wanted to match up Berry every time he could with Gilliard today.
He just wanted the ball thrown out there, but Berry.
That's a hold.
That's worse than a hold. That's brutal. He wrapped them up. That should have been a flag. The Gilliard stuck the hand up. He was there.
Capital One halftime report coming up shortly. John Saunders and Jesse Palmer with scores and highlights. Pike's 2 for his last 12 with 2 interceptions. Throws short. DJ Woods trying to get to the boundary and does. And very close to a late hit over there by Max Gruder. No flag down. And out of bounds to stop the clock at the 37.
Good awareness here by Woods. Gets the hand there. Here comes Gruder, and it's out of bounds. That's the second penalty. Should have had one down here in the 5. He should have had one right there. But good awareness by Woods of knowing where he's at, trying to stop the clock.
A very long field goal from here, about 55 yards. And Brian Kelly said, particularly going in this direction, the open end along the river, it's infamous for kickers, both college and pro levels. They might take a shot of the end zone here. Pike
sideline
throws it too high. 3 seconds left, and time for one more play.
Now you take the shot, or he can try a field goal, but he was going to try to the sideline to get out of bounds on a quick throw. Instead, they'll try a 55-yarder.
Very little breeze here. That's usually what causes the problem at this open end of the stadium. But as you can see, really very little wind. And Rogers, the junior, does have a career long of 55. This would match it. His long this season is 45. And that one has no shot. Off to the right to end the half.
It's a humdinger of a first half.
It sure has
been. Looking forward to the second.
With the Big East title and the automatic bowl bid to a BCS game going to the winner. This Brian Kelly has high standards. He thought that 55-yarder should have been a chip shot. But Dave Wanstead and his team with a 31-17 lead at the break. Here's Holly.
Coach, that was a pretty long conversation with your kicker. What were you saying?
Well, you know, just let me know. If you can't make it, I'll throw the ball in the end zone. Don't go out there and say, I can make it. And, you know, you can't get it there. He's just, you know, it's a young kid. He just wants to try to get on the field.
Coach, your defense has struggled early in this half. They had two good possessions, but what has to change with them?
We are who we are. I mean, we're not going to trade any of these guys. We just got to keep battling. You know, Pitt's a good offense. We've had a couple of good stops. We made a couple of, you know, uncharacteristic mistakes. We had one guy rush us on a punt, and we let him go through. So we just got to clean some things up and battle this thing in the second half.
All right, thanks, Coach. We are who we are. That translates to, I think they got to outscore them, guys.
Yeah, and Pike was not who he usually is. He was 8 out of 23 in the half with two interceptions. Deion Lewis, the star of the half, 29 carries for 108 yards. Along the banks of the Allegheny, Pittsburgh leads Cincinnati 31-17 at the half. Let's join John Saunders and Jesse Palmer in our Times Square studio, the Capital One halftime report. And welcome back to Heinz Field and our coverage of college football presented by K Jewelers. Getting ready for the start of the second half in this battle for the Big East Championship and the automatic bid into a BCS bowl game. Pittsburgh leads 31-17. They held that potent Cincinnati offense to 147 yards. But of course, the Bearcats got a huge 99-yard kickoff return from Marty Gilliard to get right back in the game. Sean McDonough along with Matt Millen. And I think for the most part, Dave Wanstead has to be very pleased with the way that half went, with the exception, obviously, of the kickoff return. He wanted to control the ball, and his defense played well.
Absolutely. I think that was what they planned. That's what they wanted. But there's a couple things that happened here. Like you said, Gilliard at the end of the half, that's phenomenal. That puts him right back in. It's a two-score game. I think that Brian Kelly has to be happy with only being down by two scores right here. And then the second thing is, at the end of the half, you started to see that the Cincinnati defense was starting to play well. But to me, the story of the first half, you saw Deion Lewis running, and they gave him a lot of carries, but the Pitt defense played very, very well. If they can do that in the second half, that'll be the best they've played all season, and that's what it's going to take to get this Cincinnati Bearcat team.
That was the understatement about Lewis getting a lot of carries. He had 29 carries in the first half for Pittsburgh for 108 yards. Jake Rogers kicks off. And here's Cameron Sadler up the far sideline and down at the 25-yard line. Here's a look at our Pacific Life game summary. And Deion Lewis was the story at the very beginning of the ball game. Seemed like he was going to touch the ball on every play. For a while, he did. And Tony Pike had an up and down half, mostly down. Two interceptions. He'd thrown only three all year. And when it was 31-10, Pittsburgh had just scored to take a three-touchdown lead. Marty Gilliard took 16 seconds to get Cincinnati back in the game. Here's Lewis. Well, it seems hard to believe, Matt, for all that Lewis did, he still averaged only 3.7 yards per carry. And the record, by the way, for carries in a game at Pitt is 42. By Ironhead Hayward back in 1987 against Notre Dame. 30 already now for Lewis.
Well, you know, this kid, he's got the great balance we talked about. He has the great feet in the hole and vision and all those things. What he lacks is that great burst and the next level speed. I don't know if he can run away from everybody like a Barry Sanders could, but you know, 30 carries already, they're gonna ride this horse.
Stull faked it to him, rolls out, throws on the run, incomplete. In the general direction of Mike Shanahan, here's Holly Rowe.
Well, guys, I caught up with at the half, and he said that he wanted to go for it on those two fourth down calls in the first half because he knew Cincinnati would score a lot of points and that they had to as well. I asked him about those first half penalties that seemed to really hurt his team. He said he told his guys in the locker room, I want you to be aggressive, but I want you to play clean. One other note, Cincinnati's complained about the music. This is a pro stadium, and they're playing music in between snaps. It has affected some of the communication with the Bearcats, so the officials told Dave Wanstead they got to turn off that music in between every play, or they'll get a penalty.
All right, Holly, thank you. I don't think Coach Kelly would like playing at Georgia Tech after what we heard out of the PA system there last week. Blaring noise. Lewis is smothered. Well, that's the best sequence for the Cincinnati defense all day. J.K. Schaefer and Derek Wolf there to drop Lewis, who lately cannot get free at all.
Well, that's a fantastic play by Schaefer. because Schaefer comes from the inside out, and they try to run a pick and allow Lewis to get out in the flat by himself. But Schaefer does a fantastic job. Even though he misses to the inside where the friends can come and help him.
Will they kick it to Gilliard now? Dave Wanstead said, don't be critical of our punter if he punts it out of bounds. We don't want to kick it to Gilliard. And he did kick it to Gilliard. Dan Hutchins kicked it right to Gilliard. Oh, and if he had broken free from that tackle, he had some room to maneuver. Taken down by Nate Nix, who's been a special team star. He blocked the punt that led to a pit score in the first half. And he stopped Gilliard after a 7-yard return of a 46-yard punt. So they're trailing at the half for the first time since their loss in the Orange Bowl to Virginia Tech.
Sean, you mentioned about that was a big series. And if you would have seen the sideline on that third down, the whole team was jumping up and down. They knew they had to stop because they're going to like what they have here in the second half with Pike.
And now can Pike find his game? He comes out slinging. And intended for Marty Gilliard, incomplete. And Dave Wanstead didn't like the penalties on the defense, as Holly Rowe reported, but they were very fortunate.
Yes.
Late in that first half, there weren't a few more key penalties against the Pittsburgh defense.
Well, there's one that Brian Kelly and the staff are not going to like at all, and that there should have been an interference call on that down around about the 5-yard line.
Mike now 8 out of 24 passing. Under pressure and will not escape this time. Down back of the 28. Gus Mostakis, senior from South Florida, came here in part because he's a big Dolphin fan and loved the fact that the former Dolphin coach Dave Wanstead recruited him to Pittsburgh.
Look down here, nowhere to go. Look up top, nowhere to go. In the center of the field, good coverage by Jared Holley. And then Mostakis takes advantage of the coverage down the field and gets himself a sack.
Loss of 5, first time they've sacked Pike. But they have pressured him several times. Trouble with the snap, and he has to cover it back of the 20-yard line.
That'll go as another sack for Mostakis. That's an FOP, fall on pile. It's just a little off course, and Pike can't handle it. And Mostakis comes in and gives him a belly flop. You gotta love that. You get a tackle, oh boy, look at this. Let me give you a, have some of this belly. I want you in my belly.
Well, Pike continues to struggle. You wonder if they would think about Kolaris, at least for a moment, for a changeup. They come after the punt again. Short punt from Jake Rogers. And it rolls down to the 42. Holly.
Brian Kelly strongly talking to Tony Pike right now after that last disaster series. He turned to Zach Kolaris behind him and said, go get ready, kid. They're going to make a change.
11:47 to go, third quarter. Pittsburgh up by 2 scores. Zach Kolaris has been warming up, getting ready to come in at quarterback for Cincinnati. They're down by 2 touchdowns. Their defense on the field. Pike on the bench had an animated chat with Brian Kelly as he came off the field. Here's Ray Graham. 7 yards, but there is a flag down near the line of scrimmage.
Holding. Offense. Number 1. 10-yard penalty. First down.
Cedric McGee, a wide receiver, called for the hold. Holly.
It was a pretty strong conversation, but after they got over here to the sideline, they tried to calm things down. Brian Kelly was talking to Tony Pike, but the wide receivers are frustrated right now. I just saw Ben Gadouli and Marty Gilliard trying to explain what's going on, and they got a little bit, you know, animated, I guess I would say. So finally Brian Kelly just said, all right, everybody just relax. They just need to take a deep breath right now.
And Brian has calmed down. He makes no secret, he's not afraid to get after anybody on that sideline. Assistant coaches, players, officials, ball boys.
Hey, it's his show, and I like that in a head coach. That's your, it's inevitably, it comes down to you. Get it right.
After the penalty, here's Graham again. Bounces outside. And a good run. Got the penalty yardage back and then some. out across the 45, 13-yard gain. It seems hard to believe, but Frank Cignetti said yesterday they think Graham has just as much talent as Lewis, maybe not quite as polished as a freshman as Lewis, but close.
He doesn't have the make you miss as much as Lewis does in the shake, but he's faster. And I know one thing. I know that high school coach he had. Chet Parlavecchio would tell you he's a player. He's a player. That kid knows players.
Frank Cignetti done a wonderful job in his first year here as the offensive coordinator. Graham slipped as he took the handoff. He's a Pittsburgh native, grew up here. His dad, Frank Cignetti, former Pittsburgh assistant back in the late 60s, was the head coach at West Virginia and Indiana University of Pennsylvania. So Frank's been around it his whole life. Last year was the offensive coordinator at Cal in a very good situation with a good team and with a head coach he really liked. But the lure of coming back to this city he loves and working in this program brought Frank Cignetti here. And Dave Wanstead gives him a lot of credit for the success of this offense. Third down and 9. Out of the gun, stall, and incomplete. Intended for Dorian Dickerson. And it looked like it would have been short of the marker anyway. Dorian Davis, who sees a lot of action as a backup linebacker, had the coverage.
Well, Davis does have the coverage, and the ball's thrown low and outside. It looks like that's an incompletion. That's a good call. But look, this is we said at the end of the first half, that Cincinnati defense is starting to pick it up, and that's another good series.
Two straight three and outs forced by the Cincinnati defense after a frenetic pace to this game in the first half. The defenses are taking over. High and very short punt off the foot of Dan Hutchins.
Now that was pathetic.
Well, they want to keep it away from Gilliard. Dave wants that set. Now don't get on the kicker if he punts it out of bounds.
I could see putting it out of bounds down the field, but holy smokes, that was shanky very much.
There's a flag down, the official far sideline indicating holding against Cincinnati. Why would you hold when the ball was going out of bounds?
Holding.
There was no
return.
Return
team, number 16. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the infraction. First down.
Marcus Bennett called for the hold. Will there be a quarterback change? Will we see Kolaris? Pike has his helmet on. We'll be back in a moment.
College football presented by K Jewelers. Brought to you by the Coach's Trophy presented by Dr. Pepper and Citizen Eco Drive. Fueled by light, it never needs a battery. Unstoppable.
John McDonough, Matt Millen, Holly Rowe. Our producer, Bo Garrett, our director, Mike Roig, our terrific ESPN ABC crew. Hasn't been a terrific day for Tony Pike. He's 3 for his last 15.
Well, they've gotten him out of the pocket, and they've gotten him out of his comfort zone. And then there's been bad snaps, and there's been all kinds of things that have gone on, but they've gotten to him, and you can see him on the sideline. They had a little animated conversation. They calmed them all down. Holly Rowe just told us everybody will remain calm, and away they go.
We told Kolaris to warm up, but Brian Kelly did not go to the bullpen. Isaiah P. carries, and he gets 8. After the heat of the emotions calmed down a little bit, Kolaris, who threw some warm-up throws and rode the bike, still over there cheering him on. He was 4-0 as a starter when Pike was injured. And there was some question, would Pike go back as the starter when he was healthy? Because Kolaris played so well. But Ryan Kelly said Pike is their number one quarterback, and for most of the year, he's been one of the best in the country. Throwing a deep ball, and it's incomplete. Intended for Armand Bins, with coverage from Giovanni Chappelle. And right now, neither offense can get anything done.
You know, that's been a nice matchup all day long. Bins and Chappelle. Again, see, gets the push. You go from hips to eyes, and once the receiver eyes get big, that's when you make your play on the ball. Chappelle's done it a few times here today.
Pike had a big game last year against Pitt in Cincinnati, completed 80% of his passes, threw for 309 yards and 3 touchdowns. Been a different story today. Cincinnati only 2 out of 8 on third down, and that number's going to get better on a nice catch by DJ Woods. sophomore from Strongsville, Ohio. We started to mention it earlier. He was a big time recruit. And now look like Dave wants it, trying to say it's incomplete. The officials do not agree. It's a catch. Brian Kelly said in part Woods, because he came to Cincinnati, is opening Cincinnati up to other big time recruits. They're starting to consider his program more often. Pike surrounded and stumbles down. That's a sack.
Looks like Nick
Miles
Williams.
Carrigine.
Yeah, nice. And Williams is right there. They collapsed the inside of the pocket, John, and they had good coverage down the field. And Pike tried to get out of it. He does manage the pocket pretty well. He has pretty good movement. But watch Carrigine on the inside and Williams right there. And they get just enough of them to set up this second down.
This is not the kind of pace Cincinnati wants. They'd like to get it back into an up-tempo game when they're on offense. Deep ball, Gilliard's open.
Touchdown.
Forget about it. Marty Gilliard, another long score, 68 yards. Cincinnati within a touchdown.
All it takes is one big play. Gilliard gave it to him in the first half, and he gives it to him again, and now it's a one score game.
The 99 yard kickoff return in the first half by Gilliard when they were down 31-10, and now a 68 yard touchdown. They're all happier on that sideline now.
Yeah, it's funny how that works.
Ryan Kelly's faith in Pike rewarded with a long touchdown pass. Jake Rogers the extra point. And Cincinnati with a long way to go is within 7.
Watch them up top. And they're going to go the little Phil fake on the front end of it. Right there, see? And then he gets on top. Now watch Holly. A little too high. He gets too high on the defender. His angle coming down was to the top shoulder. Needed to be on the inside. Couldn't get there. And then it's out the gate.
They went 78 yards after the penalty on the punt, which was the first penalty of the day against Cincinnati. Only 5 plays to do it. Typical UC drive, 1:38. And they're all holding hands and singing songs on the sideline over there now.
This is real close. You can hear Kumbaya.
And Pike has now thrown a touchdown pass in 17 straight starts. And Marty Gilliard showing why he's an All-American.
The ball was just out of the hands of Elijah Fields. It looks like he almost mistimed his jump a little bit, but Jared Holley's got to make that play. That's what a free safety is supposed to do. You're the last line of hope.
Jake Rogers to kick off. Bouncing kick, tough to handle. And then Ray Graham slipped down. But we're starting to see the effect of this off and on light snow. Tuesday night, Disney presents its first animated television special made exclusively for ABC. It's Disney Prep and Landing. This new holiday special tells the story of the elite unit of elves who prepare houses for Santa's arrival. Get your family ready for the holidays with this instant Christmas classic. Disney's Prep and Landing, Tuesday at 8:30, 7:30 Central on ABC.
Tony something. Pike. There you go. Tony Pike. Can't beat that. Yes, sirree. I'll take 4 for Alex.
Isaiah Pede weaving across the 30 to the 31. Quality 7-yard gain on first down. Well, Brian Kelly stuck with Pike. When we spoke with him the other day, Brian said Pike is a special player. Our offense really starts with him.
Oh, they're outnumbered on the top. They need to push over. We'll take a look at Kelly. He knows it too.
Yeah. Flag down and Gilliard down after a short gain, about a yard.
Nickel shift on the offense.
I would decline.
5-yard penalty. Second down.
You see, they take Pede and they take him all the way out from the backfield and send him to the far side. And then he realizes he shouldn't be that wide, and he comes back down inside, and the ball snapped, and he's not set. I would decline that penalty. I would have put it, because the difference between you know, third and five or third and eight and third and four, really not that big a difference. Yeah.
Second and eight now instead of probably third and about four, as you said. Pike steps into a throw, has his man. First down, Armand Benz. Tripped up at the 42-yard line by Dom DeCicco. 16 yards, first down, Cincinnati.
Romy has had some pressure off the right side. You'll see him 91 coming up there, and he just steps up in the zone. Vince finds the hole. This looks like the Cincinnati team, right? It looks like they got their short straight right now, and they're playing the way they're supposed to play.
A big play offense. They have a higher percentage of plays of 15 yards or more than any team in the nation. And going for another big one, not this time. Intercepted. Jared Holly picked it off. Pike just threw it up for grabs. It was like a punt right down the middle of the field, intended for Gilliard. The third interception of the day from Pike, and Kelly can't believe it. He just has not seen that kind of play from Pike.
And he's eyeballing him the whole way. And it's Gilliard, but Jared Holly reads it perfectly. It's one of the things you like about Jared Holly. Rarely makes mistakes. He's dependable, knows where he has to be, and he has ball skill. He's a two-time All-State corner out of Easton High School in Pennsylvania, and they made the switch, and they could not be more pleased with the play of Jared Holly.
Three turnovers. They've had a punt blocked, and yet Cincinnati only down by a touchdown with 2:22 to go, third quarter. Stall with a flag down, throws it out in the flat for Doran Dickerson.
That's going to be a hold right there. Yeah, Walter Stewart got his hands on it as he came out of the backfield.
Holding, defense, number 54. 10-yard penalty, automatic, first down.
Yeah, Sean, you and I were talking in the intermission about Cincinnati taking care of the inside running game and stuffing that. Said you got to get to the edge, whether it's a pitch or what they were doing earlier with Graham running outside, or that a short passes just start to work the edges.
Crowd trying to get back into it. This place was on fire in the first half, but the offense has been stuffed lately by this Cincinnati defense, and that continues. Lewis straight ahead for two. J.K. Schaefer the tackle. Holly.
Guys, just before the half, when Pitt was really running up and down the field on the Cincinnati defense, Ricardo Matthews on the sideline was yelling at his guys, read your keys. He kept screaming it over and over, particularly to the young interior defensive linemen, read your keys. Now they've come out and he's reading it. What he's yelling is, they're frustrated. We're getting to them. They're getting frustrated. Keep it up. So you've got to believe they've made a change in possibly reading those keys better, Matt.
Yeah, what they're doing there, Holly, is just, this is a gap control defense. And so you have to maintain your discipline, and you have to take care of your gap.
Second and seven. Short pass to the tight end, Nate Byam. And he's taken down short of the first down. Byam, another senior from Franklin, Pennsylvania. An emotional senior day for him on the field before today's game. He's an excellent player out there on the field with his grandfather, Ron, who basically raised him. His mom was 16 when he was born, has battled drug and alcohol problems her entire life. And his dad, who lives in a trailer home about an hour and a half from here, his granddad, raised Nate. And that was a wonderful scene on the field before the game today. And his mom was here today, too. She's starting to get her life together. This beautiful throw by Stahl. And Jonathan Baldwin, the catch for a first down. Brad Jones had the coverage. And senior day is always emotional, Matt. And I know you remember your last game, but Nate said he was going to be fighting back the tears when he got out on the field, saw his mom and his granddad. He wouldn't be here without Ron.
Those are always tough. Tough on moms, tough on grandparents, and tough on the players.
Yeah. Nate said, I'd like to make it in the NFL so I can help my grandfather. He said, but he doesn't want anything.
Well, that's the way grandpops are. Mm-hmm. That's the way they should be. But that kid will have his chance of playing.
And I think Nate has a chance to give granddad what he wants most of all, a win. They're 15 minutes away from it in a tight game with the Big East title up for grabs. Cincinnati had its back against the wall in the Big East championship game. They were down by 21. Now it's a 7-point game. We welcome you back to college football presented by K Jewelers. Pittsburgh did not score in the third quarter. They're scoring their first five possessions. Bill Stull going deep. First play of the fourth quarter, and it's intercepted. Dominique Battle picks it off for Cincinnati.
I don't know where he was trying to throw that ball. There was a defender on the inside to Dickerson and Baldwin on the outside, and he split the difference. We'll say this, the defender was wide open. He hit him right in stride. That's a nice job of going and tracking that ball.
These two teams are among the teams in the country that have the fewest turnovers. Cincinnati had the fewest coming in, 7. Pittsburgh had committed only 11, but Stahl's just thrown his second interception. It's the second of the season for Battle, a sophomore from Boca Raton, Florida. So Cincinnati down by a touchdown from its own 7. Opening seconds of the fourth quarter. Pike, play action pass. Caught, and then it pops loose. Hit Armand Benz, then popped away with Giovanni Chappelle nearby, and Benz is chagrined that he couldn't come up with it.
You know, that's been a nice battle all day long. Benz will go get the ball. He just couldn't quite hold on to that one. But Chappelle, of course, it's a run out, and then he's going to make the break to come back. You're going to give that underneath stuff up, and you're going to come down and make the tackle. And that's exactly, he's playing it right.
You would say Armand had trouble tucking it into the Benz.
Dun-dun-dun.
Hello. We go to your waiters and waitresses. Second and 10. Pike, another inside fake. Going deep. Gilliard's behind the defender. And it is incomplete. Aaron Berry had the coverage. If Pike had thrown that deeper and let Gilliard run under it, he was gone again, because as that ball was in the air, Gilliard was behind Berry.
And watch Berry. He's going to skate to the top, and then he shakes him right there. It's a double move. And Berry, ooh, boy, that's another one that's close of running up on that thing. Gilliard doesn't come down with it.
Big third down. Third down and 10. Pike design roll. Waving receivers. Throws it away. Three and out for the Pittsburgh defense. Jamal Sheard made life difficult for Pike.
Yeah, and he was looking again for Gilliard, and you saw him motioning down the field. And this time, DeSico came over the top, Jared Holley came over the top, and you still had Berry there. So, why? Here's Berry on the top side, and they're playing the zone. He's going to run to the top, and now see Gilliard come through. And Holley takes care of it. Boy, that kid Holley has played a heck of a game here today.
Phil Bennett has to be so pleased with the way his defense is played. Pittsburgh blocked the punt. This one's a line drive shot off the foot of Jake Rogers.
That's returnable.
Aaron Smith has blockers and brings it all the way back near the 30-yard line. That was a low line drive kick. Rogers well aware of the history. Ryan Woodard saved the touchdown perhaps for Cincinnati. 43-yard punt. 18-yard return.
It's a low line drive, very returnable. It gets to the receiver, the returner, quicker than your coverage can get there. But here's the key. Watch the blocks. They set up the wall. And Woodward, he comes through. That is a fantastic job, because that could have been your right, Sean. That was a touchdown.
Yeah, it looked like it might go when he started to come over by the near sideline. Pitt leading by 7. Lewis spins to the 29-yard line. Even a field goal here would be huge to make it a two-score game. Lewis got off to a great start, but they've done a good job against him lately.
Well, when he gets to the edge, and he has that, like we've talked about, documented all game long, he can shake you, he can make you miss, has uncanny balance. What he lacks is a burst and that next level speed. If he had that, there's a couple of runs he could have hit another gear and gotten some big stuff.
35 carries for Lewis. 36 carries for Lewis. He's inside the 25 and about 2 yards short of a first down, tackled by Aaron Webster. He's also, by all accounts, a very impressive young man. Dave Wanstead, he looked at that highlight tape, saw 6 places to give him a scholarship, said, but let's bring him in and get a measure of him as a person. He said as soon as he met him, talked to him, he came through a terrific prep school environment at Blair Academy, well raised by his folks in Albany. Just a neat kid. Adam Gunn, the linebacker, said he's the most mature freshman we've had in this program. Six away from the single game record for carries. First down, Lewis weaves his way to the 15-yard line. Certainly in field goal range now with 13 minutes to go in the battle for the Big East title.
Boy, he's good in traffic. He is good in the soup. Watch Hynoski. Now watch everybody. Just great patience. And then come back inside, see the feet, and then the dart. He just had that one more gear. That'd be real. I mean, he's special so as it is. But if he had another gear, we'd be hanging his banner up in a few years next to TDs.
Joe Thomas helped lead the way. Four-year starter at left guard. They've had so many great players here at Pittsburgh, and that's one of the things the coaches sell. The great tradition here. Lewis, touchdown! Put the banner up for Deion Lewis.
You are 100%. He keeps running like that. We'll be watching the unfurling of that banner in a few years.
And good play calling. Worked well in the previous play. It looked like just about the same play dialed up by Frank Cignetti. 15-yard touchdown. All four carries on that possession from Deion Lewis. They're starting to think about a BCS bowl, but a long way to go against this high-scoring Cincinnati team. Well, they don't have a banner up yet for Deion Lewis. They have his picture in the stands. He's become an immediate fan favorite with a tremendous freshman season. And he continues to break records. Now the Pitt freshman scoring record with his second touchdown of the day. And 160 yards today. He's only 80 away from breaking Tony Dorsett's freshman rushing record at Pitt. And he has a bowl game still to come. Will it be a BCS bowl game? If they hang on to the lead and win it, it will be. 12:26 to go as Dan Hutchins kicks off. Short and down to Darren Williams. And look at him go. Actually, it's Gilliard who returns it. All the way to the 24-yard line. Looked like Williams was in position to field it, but they want Gilliard to handle it when he can, and he did, and he almost broke it all the way. Took it back 48 yards to the 23-yard line.
That is smart by Brian Kelly and his special team staff, because they took Gilliard where he normally is and put him up in that position, anticipating a short kick, and then he brings it back and puts him into great scoring position.
Even when they try to kick it away from him, they can't. Every time they've needed a big play today, Gilliard's given it to him. 230 yards on kickoff returns. 87 receiving yards, including a long touchdown. They need to score quickly, and he's put them in position to do it. Of course, they can score quickly on a long field, too. Toward the end zone it goes. Incomplete. Mike was throwing into the direction of Gilliard, and Aaron Berry had the coverage.
Yeah, they had a nice zone going there. Holly pushed Berry over to the side, and watch. You're going to see that they're going to try to get to the corner back here. Berry does a nice job of staying on one, which is the outside receiver, and reading two, which is the second receiver, and he takes right into his zone.
Quick toss. Isaiah Pede. Down to the 17-yard line, tackled by Greg Romeus, and the clock runs under 12 minutes remaining in this Big East title game.
Sean, did you see Romeus get from the inside out? That Pete can go. Romeus turned right away and took an angle and set up this third down. It's a nice play.
And a big one it is. You wonder if they're in four down territory, down by two touchdowns. A long way to go. Moot point. It's a first down. Gilliard looked like he juggled it a bit, but held on for the catch. And another big play they need, they get from Gilliard. Jared Holly, the tackle.
Here we go. It's just in the slot right here. You can watch Gilliard. He's just going to go down and sit down. And they're playing off in the zone, which in the third short is, you know, they're going to have to match up down here. Now it's red zone time for Pike, where he's been good, and red zone time for the defense, which has been really good today.
Best red zone quarterback in the country this season.
Locked up both sides.
Tony Pike, one of the best red zone defenses in the country, on defense in Pittsburgh, and Pike wins the battle. Touchdown, DJ Woods.
Beat Jared Holley. Holley gave too much, tried to take away the inside, and then Woods takes the outside. Woods gets out of his break really well. See it right down here. Holly's trying to take away the inside, so Woods sees it's fine. I'll take the outside. He's going to beat Holley to the break, and it's six.
And here's a very important extra point from Jake Rogers. Make it a 7-point game, and it hits the upright. No good. Kolaris, the holder, looked like the ball was moving around a bit. And Jake Rogers, a rare miss. He was 56 out of 57 for the season entering today. And this is his first miss of the day.
College football on ABC, presented by King Jewelers, the number one jewelry store in America. John Hancock, the future is yours. And Bud Light, with the just right taste that's not too heavy, not too light. The difference is drinkability.
Back in the Steel City, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. The Cincinnati Bearcats. A lot of mistakes today, uncharacteristic of Brian Kelly's team. Three interceptions. The extra point a moment ago, the blocked punt. They missed a 55-yard field goal as well. But they're within a touchdown and now a 2-point conversion. And still plenty of time left as Jake Rogers kicks off. Cameron Sadler from the three. Trying to cut across the field. And he gets pulled down at the 23-yard line. Tackled by Thomas Hilton. Tomorrow night at 8 Eastern on ESPN, join Reese Davis, Mark May, Lou Holtz, and Jesse Palmer for the bowl selection special. The matchups of all 34 bowl games will be announced and dissected by our analysts. Plus, we'll be joined by players and coaches from inside perspective. It's the bowl selection special, powered by Chevy Silverado. Tomorrow night at 8 Eastern on ESPN. With Mark May, one of the all-time great players here at Pitt. Hall of Fame offensive lineman. When you think about it, Dan Marino, Tony Dorsett, Larry Fitzgerald, Mike Ditka, Bill Frelich, Mark May, Hugh Green, Joe Schmidt, to name just a few. When they talk about being able to recruit on tradition, they can.
This is a great, great football town. It's always been. And it always will. They love their football here. They love the players here. They have great high school football. Pittsburgh's a place for football. You want to be there.
Frank Signetti, the offensive coordinator, says it's the best football city in America. High school, college, pro, they love it all. Stoll is sacked back at the 16-yard line by Derek Wolf.
Stoll tried to step up in the pocket. Gets the pressure from the top side, first of all, by Alex Daniels, and that forces him inside, and then Wolf, the nose tackle, comes through for the big sack. Sets up third and long.
Wolf's a sophomore. Bob Diakos is down the road. He's going to be an overwhelming player. A lot of talent. Still learning how to play. Third down and 17, as you might expect. Conservative call deep in their own territory, protecting an 8-point lead. Lewis got them out to the 25. Dorian Davis made the tackle, and now Pittsburgh will have to punt, and Cincinnati with a chance to tie it with a touchdown and a 2-point conversion.
Well, that's a fantastic job by the defense of the Bearcats. That was a big series. You have, you know, under 10 minutes now. get the ball into the hands of your offense, but also Gilliard here has a chance to, for some more magic. He's been magical all day long.
Wouldn't you kick it out of bounds again?
I would.
Let's see what Dan Hutchins does. Angling toward the far sideline.
That's a good punt.
Yeah, that's well done. Out of bounds, good distance, and no chance to be returned. Let's check in with Matt Weiner in New York.
Thank you, Sean. It's a Taco Bell update on the Conference USA Championship game. Case Keenum uncharacteristically has thrown a pair of interceptions in this game, but he also has four touchdowns. That's very characteristic. That one to LJ Castile, and they're back within five of East Carolina.
Conference USA Championship game there. Big East title game here. Cincinnati once down by 21 points. Within eight after a missed extra point after their last score. Tony Pike has had an up and down day, but he's been a lot better in the second half than the first. Line judge blows the whistle for a timeout called by the Pittsburgh Panthers.
Pittsburgh, first of the half.
.854 to go. Time for our Pacific Life game summary. 8:54 to go, fourth quarter, an 8-point lead for the Pittsburgh Panthers. Their defense played very well, held Cincinnati to 258 yards. It's a Cincinnati team that averages 472 yards per game. But the defense put on a spot again here, trying to protect an 8-point lead.
And so you look at all those numbers in the time of possession, you throw it all out the window, because they're one play away from tying this thing up.
The handoff to Isaiah Pede, and Adam Gunn tackled him, but it's a quality gain on first down for Cincinnati. 8 yards. Second down and two. The snow continues to fall. It's been flurries throughout the day, the temperature hovering right around the freezing mark. This new field has held up pretty well. Recently resodded. Pike throws, has his man, first down into Pittsburgh territory, and then a hit out of bounds. DJ Woods caught it, and then Jared Holley with the late hit.
They're putting Holley in a position to cover the slot, and he's playing off. And you're going to run that out all day long.
Answer the play. Personal foul. Defense. 15-yard penalty. First down.
They're trying to make it look like you're going to keep your safeties deep. But what they're doing, they're just going to take this guy, they're going to run him out of here. And then Holley is locked up on him. And he's going to try to take away the inside because there's nobody in the middle of the field. Well, you give up the out all day long.
Well, the crowd just saw a replay. They didn't think this was a late hit. But it was.
It was a hit. Late one. Good call.
14-yard pass play, 15-yard penalty, 29 in all. They're at the 31-yard line. 8 points away from a tie with 8 minutes to go. Little shovel pass inside to Ben Gadooly, the tight end. Brother of Gino Gadooly, a four-year starting quarterback for Cincinnati. They've both had excellent careers. That's about a 6-yard gain.
Yeah, Elijah Fields comes from the inside out and makes that tackle, but this Cincinnati offense, you're starting to feel it. And this Pittsburgh crowd can start to feel it too, because here they come.
Cincinnati's won 17 straight regular season games. Gilliard, first down, slipped as he tried to make a move. And they're at the 17-yard line. It was DJ Woods the catch. Jared Holley gets credit for the tackle. D Smart reminds Brian Kelly.
They're gonna have to change up. You're gonna be giving that away. Now they're walking up a little bit.
And Pike has found the range. 5 completions in a row. 4-man rush. Single coverage. It is caught at the goal line, but not into the end zone for Armand Benz. Javadi Chappelle kept him out, but it'll be first and goal from inside the one.
So they like the matchup on the top side. It's Chappelle and Benz. It's been there all day. Now watch Benz not let him score. It's where the ball is, not where the body is. He does not break the plane. And a nice job of holding him back. They may look at that, but it didn't look like it broke the plane.
Now they're going to see if the plane was broken by Armand Bins or did Chappelle keep him out.
Bins will go get the ball. And that's, they put it up high. Now watch where the ball is. Does it break the plane? Doesn't look like it.
No, it doesn't look like it. And again, call on the field was no, so it has to be clear video evidence, conclusive, to overturn it. They're there to correct obvious mistakes, and that official you circled, Matt, certainly had great position.
Yeah, what he doesn't see, though, is where the ball is buried in his midsection right there. And don't forget, on this side down here, there's another official looking across the field.
Scoring on the field is confirmed. First down, Cincinnati.
It's good officiating.
I like the emphasis on confirmed. We got it right.
Yeah, exactly. I tell you, the other thing they got it right is getting the ball to Bins. Bins and Wood right now, Woods rather, have taken them right down the field. And part of it is schematically, they're just taking what the defense, the weakness of the defense. You can't expect that corner, in this instance, the safety, Holly, to be able to take that out and throw.
And here is Zach Collaros in. Looked like he juggled the handoff, kept it. And he did not get in. Tried to stick it in the belly of Pete. Don't know if he intended to give it to him or take it back, but that was almost a malfunction. Well, maybe not. Looked like it from here.
well you know, it did look like it. And they are short. That's good. That's good defense there. But he's got the feet and he's got the running skills, and that's why he's in right now.
And he stays in. And that time he did collide with Pete. And he didn't get to the goal line. Jabal Sheard, it's actually a loss on the play, and there is a flag now.
That may go against the defense of lining up in the neutral zone.
Offside. Defense, number 18. Half the distance to the goal, second down.
That's the safety, Holly, up in the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, he's walked up, and he's in the neutral zone. He's lined up right there. Freshman red shirt. Gonna have to have a little bit more awareness.
Huge penalty. It's still Collaros, the sophomore. He did give it to Pete, who found the end zone. Touchdown, Bearcats. A two-point conversion away from a tie game with 5:46 to go.
I was wondering when it'd get to Pete. That's the guy you want to get the ball in his hands. And now Pike comes back as they're going to go for the two-point conversion.
And Pike, after a stretch earlier in the game when he completed only 3 out of 16 passes, has hit his last 7.
They got to take this slot receiver. Nobody's on him.
First two-point try of the year.
Walk up on him.
Pike throws back of the end zone, caught. And it's that man again, Marty Gilliard. The battle for the Big East title and a BCS bowl bid is tied at 38 with 5:46 to go.
We told you on the front end that Marty Gilliard is special with the ball in his hands. We said in the receiving and also in the return game, and he's been all of that.
Welcome back to college football presented by K Jewelers. Cincinnati trailed 31-10. Marty Gilliard, a kickoff return to help turn the momentum. 327 total yards. He averages an astounding 187 per game, and he has broke that average today.
He's been the whole show. And it's not only with his physical skills, we'll show you on the touchdown. It's with his eyes and being on the same page with the quarterback.
The Big East title on the line. Just under 6 minutes to go in a tie game. Cameron Sadler. Good kickoff return. Back to the 33-yard line. Home as Hilton made the tackle.
Here's Pete, 23. He's going to just simple job of following your offensive line and getting to the edge. That's the touchdown for Pete. And now I want you to watch this. There's nobody here. The quarterback sees it and Gilliard sees it. He knows he has one guy man-to-man to beat him with no help to the inside. So shake him right there. He freezes Holly's feet, gets to the middle of the field, and it's six.
And Lewis is stuffed. Credit to Cincinnati defense. What a turnaround. J.K. Schaefer and Derek Wolfe made the plays there. But this was a Pittsburgh offense. In their first two possessions of the game, kept it for more than 6 minutes, both possessions, 12 play drives. They scored on each of their first five possessions. Here in the second half, they've had 90 yards of offense, Pittsburgh.
And they've been terrific. And they've been bringing their backers inside and taking away and throttling up the inside. And so they're forcing Pittsburgh to say, okay, you're not going to beat us with Deion Lewis. Stowe, you beat us.
And it is Stowe back to throw. Zips one. Caught. Nice move after the catch by Baldwin. And he's very close to the first down marker with the forward progress. Schaefer drove him back. You can see the officials are marking it on that yellow line. Likely to be a first down. Gerard McGinn called on the chains for a measurement.
Might be a tad short.
The yellow line is accurate, and I think it almost always is. And if you want to bet on anything in life, bet on that yellow line.
I'm reading it from up here. I didn't even look at the line yet. So I'm probably
look
wrong.
At the line.
Like I said, it looked like a first down. Didn't I say that?
Yes,
yeah,
all
I
the way.
So. Thought so.
Might have seen some writing, too, on that ball. They wrote Foch on the footballs in memory of Foch Fazio, the former Pitt coach who passed away after a long battle with leukemia this week. Foch is a pretty generous spot.
Yeah, and it looked like it was there, but Foch Fazio was a favorite of anybody. Anybody who knew Foch Fazio, you were happy you knew the man. That guy was he was a star.
Longtime college and NFL coach. And in recent years a commentator on the Pittsburgh radio broadcast. Bill Hillgrove and Bill Frelick. Just one of the most well-liked people in football for a long time. Head coach, longtime assistant, great recruiter because of his personality. Died at the age of 71 on Wednesday night after a long battle with leukemia. And our condolences to the Fazio family.
Always, that's a great picture because that's the way Foch always was. Always had a smile on his face. Always a kind word for anybody.
Deion Lewis. Another first down, and there's a flag down back near the line of scrimmage. And right in the middle
personal
of the line.
Foul. Defense, number 54. Hands to the face, 15-yard penalty. First down.
That's Walter Stewart, the defensive end. Hands to the face. I saw a helmet come flying off on the inside.
That is a huge penalty. That's going to move him down to field goal range.
Yeah, he's working on Hynoski, and you see, he just took his helmet off. he got up. You can go to the throat. They won't call that. Once you get up into the face, they're going to flag that every time.
Meanwhile, it was the 43rd carry of the day for Deion Lewis, breaking Ironhead Hayward's single game Pittsburgh record. Another run blitz. And a bounce to the outside and another flag as they take down Lewis by the face mask. Ricardo Matthews didn't mean to, but he did.
That's a tough call. I mean, every time I see that from defenders, that you're grabbing for anything, especially against a back like this who can shake you. And Ricardo Matthews, he's played a good game. He just got his hand in the wrong spot.
There's no flag on the play for a face mask. Second down.
Well, he didn't mean to, and apparently he did not. Yeah. After the officials conferred, they originally deemed that he did. They threw the flag.
It came across his face. They picked it up.
That's a point of emphasis this year too. Yeah. That is supposed to be flagged. It says right in the rule book, if there's any question that if you took him down with the face mask, it is to be called a penalty. Certainly they had questions because they threw the flag and then they talked about it. If there's any question, it is to be called. Lewis, the ball carrier, and now a timeout called by Cincinnati. Curtis Young made the tackle. Each team with two timeouts in a tie game with 2:44 to go. The winner gets the BCS bowl bid out of the Big East. If Pittsburgh wins, they'd be co-champion. If Cincinnati wins, they'd be conference champs outright. Let's check in now with Matt Weiner in New York.
All right, Sean, SportsCenter right now is presented by Best Buy. Crunch time in the Conference USA Championship game. Case Keenum has thrown his fifth touchdown pass of the game to James Cleveland. They missed their third PAT of the game, and then the onside kick was recovered by East Carolina. The Pirates are now trying to run out the clock on their home field for a second straight title.
Well, Dave Wanstead still very agitated during Matt Weiner's update, giving it to the referee about this no call, originally a flag thrown for a face mask.
Well, he has it initially and then he comes off, and you're right, Sean, the rule book, the rule says what it says, and they picked it up. But hey, that doesn't matter now. There's been a play run. You got to play. Forget about that. And it's third down. Stoll's got to make a play here.
Be a long field goal from here on a slick field. Third down and nine. Stoll steps into a throw and has his man. First down, Jonathan Baldwin fighting for every inch. Down at the 13-yard line.
That's what you want out of your senior quarterback. How far did he come? This is how far. It's a big game. You need a big play. Everybody in the house knows you're going to throw it, and you have to deliver. And he does.
Sixteen-yard gain. Stoll's gone over 5,000 yards passing for his career today. Sixth all time at a school with some terrific quarterbacks throughout its history. Back to Lewis. Turning the corner. And out of bounds near the 5-yard line. What with he exactly 2 minutes to go.
And what he didn't want to do is get out of bounds. He wanted to keep that clock running. Better awareness, but watch the bounce. It's well blocked. Shanahan allows him to be able to get to the edge. He needed to stay in to keep that clock running. Now it is running anyway. I'm sorry.
Yeah, because before 2 minutes.
Right. All right. Hey, never mind. All you people listening out there, I didn't really mean that anyway.
46. He shattered the record from the late Ironhead Hayward. Four carries more than his record back in 1987. On second down, Lewis again. Touchdown!
Again, Hynoski. They've been running this play all game long.
There's the great Tony Dorsett on the sideline, watching a lot of his records get shattered. Trouble on the extra point. Andrew Janoco, the holder, picks it up, but he won't get there. Oh, could that be huge? It's a 6-point game. With 1:36 to go, and these Pitt fans are well aware how quickly Cincinnati can strike.
He just put the ball down and slipped out of his hand.
Yeah, perfect snap by John Figger with the holder Janoco. Didn't get it down cleanly, and the ball never did get up off the foot of Dan Hutchins.
Watch Hynoski there. And you're also going to watch right there, Joe Thomas, 56. Just follow him in. Another good job by Malecki, 77. Dave, he was happy about that. And Tony Dorsett, he's happy about that. But they can't be happy about the missed extra point.
Because you said it right, Sean. This is a quick strike offense with a minute 36.
That could be the missed extra point to cost you the league championship in a BCS bowl if Cincinnati can go down quickly and score and kick an extra point. Of course, they botched one earlier and had to go for two after their last touchdown to get even. Nine plays on the drive, seven runs by Lewis, and the two key passes to Baldwin to cover the 67 yards, the last five on the run by Lewis. The winner gets the Big East BCS automatic bowl berth. 1:36 to decide it. And again, Gilliard looms as the return man for Cincinnati.
Plenty of time. Two timeouts. They stop the clock on first down, just all kinds of time.
He has 230 yards of returns. Will he have a chance to do it again? Yes, he will. Marty Gilliard. Oh, he slipped. Bounced off a couple of hits, and then as he went to make a move at the 37, he slipped. Panthers are saying they have the ball. The officials are saying no, Gilliard's down, but he's given Cincinnati excellent field position. 26-yard return. Yep, just as he went to cut, his feet slipped.
He has been electric all day long.
Cincinnati, 61 yards away. Pike, under duress, throws it to the far sideline. Caught by Gilliard, tackled in bounds by Fields. Cincinnati with two timeouts left, 1:17 on the clock running. They have an experienced quarterback running the show. And one of the best play callers in the country dialing up the call. Four-man rush again. Pike over the middle, caught again. First down to the 44-yard line of Pittsburgh. DJ Woods tackled by Aaron Berry, 1:02 to go, 15 yards.
He's going to go with a three-man rush and get coverage. Pike has him right where he wants him.
Tight formation, all the receivers in close. Pike has some running room. Still behind the line, lofts it over the middle, caught. First down, 28-yard line. Gilliard again, 15 yards, 39 seconds to go.
Fantastic by Gilliard. He sees he's in trouble and just comes back to the football. Pike sees him and he's able to make the catch.
Boy, timeout Cincinnati. I'm a bit surprised by that, Matt, in that they seem to have the Pitt defense on their heels, scrambling. The clock had stopped to move the chains. They could have gotten up there quickly, ready to go again.
Gilliard's covered, and they have a safety on top, but he sees he's in trouble and comes back all the way so Pike can spot him and picks up the first down. Well, Gilliard's played a heck of a football game. That's as good as you're going to see in the return game and in the receiving game.
Well, Heisman ballots are due on Monday.
Holy
so smokes. Already voted. Might want a chance to refigure. What a season he's had. What a career he's had. The only receiver in Cincinnati history with back-to-back 1,000-yard receiving seasons. A force, as we've seen all day in the return game. Tuesday night on ABC, premiere of the hysterically twisted, utterly original Better Off Ted with special guest star Tay Diggs, 9:30, 8:30 Central on ABC. Five receivers spread the formation for Cincinnati.
Man-to-man down here with Bins, again with Chappelle. It's been something he's liked all day, a whole lot of field to work with.
Cincinnati 28 yards and an extra point away from taking the lead. To the end zone it goes. Caught! Touchdown, Armon Bins! Flag down, line of scrimmage.
Offside. Defense, number 91. Pounds decline, touchdown.
Greg Romeus was offside and they can continue to party in the Cincinnati section. And now, the extra point to give them the lead. And bear in mind that on their last try kicking an extra point, they had trouble. Zach Kolaris, the holder, fiddled with the ball around his knee. It is good. Jake Rogers gives Cincinnati a 1-point lead, still 33 seconds to go. a 29-yard touchdown pass. Four plays, 61 yards, a minute and three. One of the best quick strike teams in the country has done it again when they needed it most.
Armin Benz right here working on Chappelle. We said it all by himself. He had a whole field. Chappelle falls down. That was the type of throw that was. He had already gotten to his top. That was going to be six regardless. So he's on top right there. And that is a perfect throw, and it's touchdown. Pike, credit Pike. It was a great throw, but he saw it right from the start. He saw the safety in the middle of the field. Nobody over there. It's one-on-one. You take your shot.
When you think back to how bad Pike was in the first half, 8 for 23, he's thrown a couple of interceptions, only his fourth and fifth of the year. All of a sudden, Pike has hit his last 11 passes, an emotional scene on the sideline. They're now 33 seconds away from an outright Big East championship. Good kick by Rogers. Ray Graham's going to run it out. And he's out of bounds at the 19-yard line. They wanted a late hit on the Pittsburgh sideline. They won't get it. And here is the difference in the game right now. The disaster on the extra point after the go-ahead touchdown was scored by Pittsburgh when Andrew Janoco, the holder, couldn't get it down for Dan Hutchins. He's hoping to have a chance to win it with a field goal, but they have a long way to go and little time to do it.
That should not, as a kick, should not have been run out. Not only did they not get the 20, but they took off 11 seconds.
So now it's Stahl with a long time to throw, but nowhere to throw it. Deflected pass incomplete. Looking in the direction of Lewis, Cedric McGee, a wide receiver, also out there. And what has been a scintillating senior season for Bill Stahl. The regular season is going to end with a dramatic thud unless he can rescue it here in the final 22 seconds.
He's got two timeouts, but he has about, oh, he's probably got 45 yards to go.
What a performance by Gilliard. You can see the emotion on his face, hoping the defense can cement it. Stahl down the seam, almost intercepted. Looking for Doran Dickerson, who was well covered. Drew Fry was nearby. Walter Stewart in the neighborhood. Third now.
Yeah, watch number two up there. It's Doran Dickerson, and he's trying to get there, and they're trying to say that Stewart interfered with them, but he has his position. Brian Kelly's hoping he was going to get a pick out of that one.
Gilliard's done it all, but all he can do now is watch. 17 seconds to go. Pittsburgh once led by 21 points, 31-10. That kickoff return by Gilliard turned it around. Jump ball for Baldwin, incomplete. That's his specialty with his size and leaping ability, but double covered. And now Pittsburgh is down to one final chance.
It's amazing that it all comes down to a missed extra point. But hey, both these teams were even. Pitt had all their chances to win this game. Cincinnati never quit. And that man,
timeout call.
Yeah, that man right there, Gilliard. Yeah, he just took the team on his back.
118 yards receiving and a touchdown and the remarkable return game. He also had the big catch on the two-point conversion. Let's check in with Matt Weiner in New York.
All right, Sean, we'll take you to Los Angeles next, where the USC Trojans are two wins away from an eighth straight 10-win season. They have to beat Arizona today for starters. Kickoff at 3:41 Eastern time.
Trojans need to win that one to keep their hope for an eighth straight 10-win season alive, but much more at stake here. The Big East BCS Bowl bid. Pittsburgh trying to share the regular season title with Cincinnati. Cincinnati's already clinched a share of its second straight Big East championship. And the holder, Janoco, just about inconsolable on the sideline. Fourth down and 10. 10 seconds to go. Pittsburgh is at its own 18-yard line. Stahl. The ball is out. And he's down back at the 10-yard line. Dorian Davis and Curtis Young. Dan Giordano also in on the play, and they're 3 seconds away. No flags on the play. Three straight incompletions and a sack for that Cincinnati defense.
That is just when you have to have a big play, just blow off the side. The right defensive end just gets off the ball fast. And he gets to Pinkston's edge. Watch 77. He gets to his edge really fast. That's Young, 98. And that's all he needed. He started it, and then Alex Daniels finished it. What a great comeback win by these Bearcats. They never quit. They had a lot of times in the middle of this game to say, hey, this thing's going wrong. And they didn't. The quarterback, Pike, got his game back together, and then Gilliard really just took this thing and ran with it, literally.
The two of them were great stars for the Cincinnati offense. Pike and Gilliard emerged. Gilliard in the kick game as well. And Cincinnati has won back-to-back outright conference champions for the first time since 1951 and 1952, where they won the Mid-American Athletic Conference. Gilliard 374 total yards, and Pike hit his last 11 passes, and the Cincinnati defense was superb in the second half. And here's Holly Rowe.
Coach, there was a point in this game you guys were down 31-10. What started to change at that point?
We just keep playing, and I told them at halftime, look, we just stay together, keep fighting. That's been our style all year, and we just made some more plays down the stretch. I'm just so proud of our football team and the way they persevered.
Tony Pike was struggling at one point in this game. You guys had some good words on the sideline. How did that get turned around?
Well, you know, I just told him you got to be more aggressive. You're in a championship game. You can't wish and hope. You got to go get it and go do it. And he responded with some big plays.
At the end of the day, though, Coach, your defense had to come alive, and they did. What was different about them?
I just think that they dug down deep. We're far from perfect defensively, but those kids played so hard and kept fighting. And again, at the end of the day, we had to make a couple of stops, and we did.
Coach, you're perfect on the season. What consideration does this team deserve?
Hey, you know, we won them all. Beat some really good football teams, and we'll be rooting hard. I love Mac Brown at Texas, but we'll be rooting pretty hard for Nebraska. Go Nebraska, go Cornhuskers.
Thanks, Coach Kelly.
If the national championship dreams are still alive, there's no question they are the Big East champions outright, and they're on their way to a BCS bowl for the second year in a row. Deion Lewis, 47 carries, 194 yards and 3 touchdowns in defeat for Pittsburgh. Along the river, they'll be talking about that missed extra point for a long time. 45-44 the final. For complete wrap-up of this game, ESPN News in just a few minutes. Great action on ABC. Arizona and USC tonight at 8. Brian Kelly be watching Texas and Nebraska. For Matt Millen, Holly Rowe, Sean McDonough, so long from Pittsburgh.